I'm Sandy Roberts from Channel 7, Australia's Olympic network. At 7, we cover some of the world's greatest sporting events, but nothing matches the size, the spectacle, and the memories of the Olympic Games. Water Vision Australia is proud to announce the launch of the history of the Olympic Games on video and DVD. The Olympic series highlights the human drama and pinnacles of achievement of 100 years of Olympic competition. With 38 fascinating videos across six categories, you can now enjoy your favourite Olympic memories again and again. Moments. Everyone, athlete or spectator, has a special memory which, in one brief moment, captures the true spirit of the Games. Golden Moments captures 100 of the greatest moments in Olympic history over five action-packed volumes. Supreme achievements and crossing the line. Closeness of victory and breaking the record. Personal achievement and emotional celebrations. Rivalry and a national pride, Olympic spirit and the medal ceremony. And volume 6 features 30 golden moments from the rich history of the Winter Olympic Games. The Olympic Spirit video charts the intriguing journeys of athletes whose dream is simply to compete well. Pursuing the dream and the will to win is dedicated to those athletes who epitomise the Olympic motto, it is not the winning, but the taking part. The struggle for women and African Americans to even participate in the Olympic competition is told in the Stride to Glory series. Three compelling videos focus on women's Olympic aspirations. The rise of the women Olympians. Speed and grace. And women at the Games. The story of African Americans at the Games completes the series, celebrating the struggle and achievements of African Americans in the Olympic arena. Each of the 10 videos in the Road to Glory series tells the dramatic story of an individual sport throughout the history of the Olympic Games, up to and including Atlanta. There's the sprinters, swimming and diving, gymnastics, figure skating, the middle distance runners, equestrian, boxing, the marathon, alpine skiing, and Nordic skiing, speed skating and ice hockey. In the history of the Olympic Games, there have been many great athletes. But has there ever been a fusion of talent like the Dream Team? There are two memorable videos. The Dream Team, the 1992 American Dream Team, and The Dream Fulfilled, the 1996 American Dream Team. The official films showcase the highlights of 11 individual Olympic Games, from the opening to closing ceremonies. London, 1948. Melbourne, 1956. Rome, 1960. Tokyo, 1964. Mexico, 1968. Montreal, 1976. Moscow, 1980. Los Angeles, 1984. Seoul, 1988. Barcelona, 1992. And Atlanta, 1996. This now brings us to Sydney 2000 and the extraordinary torch relay, leading up to the opening ceremony. 100 days, 1,000 towns, one celebration. The Sydney 2000 Olympic Torch Relay. Sydney 2000 will be the greatest Olympic Games ever, with 10,200 athletes from 200 countries striving for gold. The Olympic Games highlights will ensure that the memories and the spirit of Sydney 2000 will live forever.
On Slippery Saturday, and what a day of action it's been here in the games of the 27th Olympiad. I'm joined tonight by my colleague in league, Rampaging Roy Slaven. Roy, a very warm welcome to the dream, bro.
Yes, thank you.
Tremendous. And, tremendous. As you can see, our audience tonight is exclusively from the bar staff here in the media centre, and a tremendously lively audience they
are. You've been doing a great job.
Slippery Saturday, Roy. It goes back, I think, to about
Antwerp,
is it? Gee, it goes way back.
Way back, doesn't it?
And of course, the day that Remus Bagdonis blasted into Olympic history,
yes,
running the marathon. I think he scoured the course, to use racing parlance.
He did.
Scoured the course. Yes. Came down at the start with a nasty case of gastric.
That's right.
And just pushed on. Pushed on. Officials wanted to get rid of him. They thought it was lowering the tone of the event.
They thought it was cheating.
And so Slippery Saturday, one of the great days, of course, in the Olympic calendar.
It's lovely how these traditions come about. Isn't
it is
it?
Incredible.
Slippery Saturday,
yes.
Stupid Sunday,
yes,
all of that.
Yes.
All that lies ahead of us.
I believe, like you do, of course. Let's put our cards on the table. It's the greatest games ever in the history of the games. I mean, sure, you can go back to, you know, Athens.
Antwerp.
Antwerp and beyond, back to Athens. You know, yeah, this is in
2500 BC.
And I don't think there's been a better game. So I believe the last great games was Melbourne,
yes,
in 1956.
Yes.
And I yet can't get the struck match, or I couldn't until last night get the struck, yeah, match between Melbourne and Sydney, but, yeah, now I can. And there's a lot of bloody daylight now between Sydney and Melbourne.
Yes.
And I,
yeah,
think, Roy, that it won't take long. It might take another 22, 23 hours, about this time tomorrow night,
yes,
and we'll be declaring ourselves the greatest game ever. Because there's been a lot of rubbish in the Olympic Games. You've got to say that right,
yeah,
from the start.
Yeah.
Atlanta, horrible.
Well, Atlanta was a toilet.
Was it, Roy? Yeah,
I think Atlanta was a toilet,
yeah,
in comparison.
Yeah.
in comparison to what Sydney has done, without doubt. I mean, Helsinki
That was before.
Makes Atlanta look like a toilet.
That was before
Melbourne. That was quite ordinary.
And then, of course, you've got, you know, Rome, Tokyo, then you're Mexico City. You've got, you know, Moscow, L.A.
You've got Munich, sewage treatment works.
Montreal. Where they try to cover up, paper over the cracks.
That's right. Ordinary. Gold in 56. Gold in 2000. Yes.
7 News with Nadia Comaneci.
Nadia, as somebody who's got a perfect 10, I'm just wondering if you could score the Sydney game so far. Would you give it a 9.5?
Oh, I'll give it a 10.
A 10! And Roy, gymnastics, as we were talking to Nadia about, we were lucky enough to take the Dream Team cameras to the men's qualification rounds. Let's go to those highlights now. Australian tilt.
And here we have Damien Istra up on the floor routine, Rory.
Yes, three goes. That's a double hop there. And
the batted serve.
A flat bag, yes. And here's a complete flat bag, HG. A flat bag with how are you going? In control, because that bag at the bottom, HG, I don't know, it's under enormous pressure.
Oh, it is, especially as we see.
To a hello, boys.
Hello, boys.
Very brave. Very brave hello, boys.
Closes the door. And away he goes onto his routine. Perfect there, in a very classical style. Yes. Big images. Hands in the air. Scoring well with the hands in the air. I don't think I've seen a better hands in the air today. Over he goes there. Bang! He batted the salve again beautifully there, and it must be swelling now. It must be starting to hurt as he goes into the ground.
He'd be in agony.
He'd be absolute agony.
That's his second.
And he put 4,000 pounds of pressure, old speed, onto the salve in that region.
Oh, out of bounds! But by and large, perfectly respectful. Well done.
A brilliant display. The mince-eating Damien Istra. And, of course, now next up we should see Philippe Rizzo as Damien runs around the edge. Look at this vast crowd. It's a knowledgeable crowd. Batted Sav obviously marking very, very well with the crowd. They love to see that sort of work. Damien up now on the floor. Here he goes, Roy. It's an exciting opening.
Nice.
Look at that. He exists entirely on fruit, this boy. He lets, you know, the fruit do the talking, and he's talking nicely tonight.
Here he goes. Very exciting. Up he goes. Down.
Bang, Sav.
Sav very early on. Will he go with a hello, boys? No.
He's got the wigwams going, and then he moves on to the pommel wigwams. A little bit of a hello, boys coming up now.
Here's the hello, boys.
Yes.
Very nice. Leaning forward to a complete unexpected company. Beautiful work there, HGs.
Up, closing the door. Moving on, and that would pull in big marks with the judges. I don't care where you're from, you can't deny that hello, boys. Yeah. Tremendous. Up he goes there. He's got now this last pass to do. Hands in the air, breathing in, sucking the air in, and here he goes with a big finish.
Can he nail it? This is the big one. Oh, yes, he did.
Very good.
Slight double bounce, but apart from that, marvellous work.
And he brought Damien out of his chair to welcome Philip into this competition in no uncertain manner as he's greeted by the coach. That's a tremendous routine. And I think now we see one of my favourite competitors from Belarus, the Belarus butcher, Ivan Ivankov. Here he is on the floor routine now.
Yes, he can be sloppy, Ivan, at times, HG. Over the years, we've noticed him. He's what I call a slop merchant. And I don't know if we're going to see any slop merchant gear here this afternoon.
It's good so far, Rob.
Oh,
there's the slop, though.
That's
beautiful
right.
Pass, but straight into the slop bucket at the end. Has to correct himself and move back into the corner.
The Aussies didn't go out by that far.
No, that's right. Here he goes. Up again. That's tremendous work. That's better. He struck form at the right time, I think, Ivan.
Oh, here he is yes.
He's got the Hello Boys wigwam.
That's almost a Dutch wink, HG.
Not bad, Roy.
Not bad. A Dutch wink with a full 360-degree Hello Boys.
There it is. Tremendous. Going in. And now he's
flat bag.
To finish up with.
Hand bag and hello.
I'm still here. There's the other hand going up. Now watch this. This is tremendous here. This is a press straight off. Look at that.
It's all of me. All of me, and I'm not expecting company.
Although now I am.
Close the door. Beautiful work.
There it is.
Now complex, isn't it?
Complex, incredibly complex. He goes with the head, then he's over the top. That beautiful knee movement there. A rugby league style straightener on the post.
Will the slop merchant slop out on the last
run through? Let's have a look at him here. Let's go with him.
Oh, total slop.
It was a compost bucket hurled on the kitchen floor. That's all I can say about that.
pommel. It's an interesting technique.
It is, HG. The idea, as I understand it, certainly as I was taught, is to imagine you're spray painting with the date and to get it as even as you can and even spray over the complete pommel. Here he is beginning his spray work. Look at that.
And occasionally you'll notice the participant rocks forward and plays the flute side of the body to the pommel.
Very rare, very difficult to control that, HG.
Very difficult, as we see Nikolai on the
struggling
pommel.
With it. Yeah.
And what you've got to imagine then, if you've got a roller with the wigwams on the pommel, not often seen because you can get caught.
You can get caught.
We've seen a number of lesser competitors caught tonight wigwamming on the pommel.
Yeah.
And
look
now
at
we're
that
back
even
to
spread, HG. That even spread. That's
from the door,
beautiful work
onto
from the door, onto the pommel.
And occasionally, as I was saying, you see him rolling over, Nikolai rolling over and using the flute side. And
there it is.
Yes, a little bit of a hello, boys. I'm home. Close the door, thanks very much, and then off. I must be very happy with that. And I hope to now we can move on to the rings. And here we are, and I think it's Beresh from the Ukraine, first up on the rings.
The rings requires enormous strength, doesn't it?
Yes, Beresh. Could be a, I don't want to put the mock on the boy, but could be a gold medalist in the individual gymnastics later on. But as you point out, enormous strength. And Roy, it's all based on the idea of a bird being in a cage.
That's right.
A parrot.
Trapped parrot, you get inverted parrot.
You get parrot on the perch,
parrot
you get parrot pecking at the cuttlefish. And here he goes now. Beresh, let's see what he can do to start with.
Where's he going to take?
He's not yet on the perch.
No, here he goes. Straight into an inverted parrot.
Hanging off the perch, which is created by the
imagined perch across the ring.
Correct. Here he is on top of an
upside-down parrot.
Upside-down parrot.
Yeah. 360-degree swivel.
Round the perch.
Will he try? Yes, he's
there's
going
the
for
parrot on the perch.
Trapped parrot.
Trapped parrot there. And we hope to see him do the cuttlefish in a minute.
The most important thing, too, HG, is to keep the door completely closed.
Yes, you need buns of steel for this sort of work. And strength, upper body strength, and enormous upper strength. As the parrot, is emotive in, of course, all gymnastics work. Here he is, inverted parrot, upside down parrot. Then he comes off to dismount out into the shell grit in the bottom of the cage.
Yeah, that's very good.
We have some tremendous beauty spots around Sydney at the moment. Of course,
we've got cameras everywhere.
We have everywhere, and the city is showing itself off. Have a look at
this. This is what's happening live in Darling Harbour. Look at that party! Tourists everywhere, HG. Foreigners to our shores, just loving it.
Yes.
But it's not only there. We can go to Olympic Park.
Cauldron.
Look at the cauldron.
Here it is. Yes.
Look at that burning away.
I wish people could come out somehow, have access to it, and barbecue their chops though on it. Wouldn't that be the people's cauldron? I mean, that was the beauty of the flame. It was the people's flame.
Yeah.
You could, you know, light a cigarette off it if you wanted to. You could, you know, do a sausage in it or something like that.
Yeah.
But that seems to me just stuck out there, wasting a lot of heat.
Just a waste of gas, really.
Yeah, I mean, it looks pretty and everything, and it obviously symbolises.
What would it be? Propane, I suppose?
I suppose so, something like that.
Natural gas.
Yeah, that's right. And then we've got the Opera House. There's the Opera House and, of course, the Bridge and the Rings and G1.
That's a pretty shot, isn't it? Isn't our city just turning it on?
It is. It is just tremendous.
Just beautiful.
Tremendous.
And she also...
I'd love to see the Opera House move across the picture, though. You know, do you know what I mean? Just to surprise people.
What, on wheels?
Well, I don't know, I've just got it in mind that maybe on wheels or somebody...
Well, it's not good enough as it is. I mean,
well, just move it about.
Yeah.
Move it about a bit.
And also, we can go into the Athletes' Village and see what the legends are up there.
Oh, the legends.
They're all living there. And look, there we've got Dawn, Murray, Shirley just sitting there.
There's Dawn.
Don't know where Herb is, though.
I don't know. Dawn might be going to get a cup of tea.
Yeah, might be.
Is that Herb? That thing might be
That's Herb. Yeah, Herb. He'd be tired from putting in last night. He ran the last leg. Wake up, Herb. Come on, old bugger. Come on, Herb. Put in. You're on, fella. You knew we were going to cross. Come on, Herb, get up, you lazy bludger. Over here, up here. Herb! Come in, man. Isn't he great? God, he was good. Go back to bed, Herb. Thanks, man. Off your shoot. Go back to bed. Hop back in, old fella. You put in.
More than a man, he's a bird. More than a man, he's a god.
We made these games too friendly. They're far too bloody friendly. Oh, and yes. A case in point is the triathlon. Yeah. Run this morning, blokes running around. I mean, there's nothing more I like than seeing fit blokes dive into the harbour, swim a couple of kilometres, get out and ride a bike around, you know, the streets of Sydney, then throw the bike away and then decide they haven't done enough yet. They're going to go run and run and run and run around and round and round. Now, the three winners, which we'll see in a moment, the three winners have been living in Australia, training in Australia, seeing the course, and yet not one of them is an Australian. From memory, there's a Canadian, a German, and a lad from the Czech Republic who happens to live in Manly. I mean, we've been too bloody kind to these international blow-ins who come in here weeks before the event, get acclimatised, train with our mates, train with our coaches, know every square inch of the course they're running on, feel the water temperature in the harbour, know where the sharks are, know where the hills are, know where the bikes have to be put. I mean, I believe that if we want to get serious about these games, we have to make some stipulations. No peeking at the course beforehand. Fly in the night before. Find your own bloody accommodation. Get to the line yourself. Put your own shoes on and off you shoot. Is that being too harsh, Roy?
I don't think so. I agree with you. I know Sandy agrees with you. I know Sandy felt we're being far too friendly, bending over backwards for our international foreign guests, yes, and foreign competitors. No, I think you're right. I think local advantage, home ground advantage should mean home ground advantage.
Thanks very much.
So you come in blindfolded.
Yeah, that's right. Take it around.
Yes, here you are. Here's the starting. Yep, off you shoot.
Talk about
never seen it before.
No, give me
that's when you get home ground advantage, because they don't look stupid, they'd be going off the wrong way, or you'd have to have people pointing down that way, mate, down that way. That's how it's got to be.
Yes. So, we come to the event this morning, the triathlon, and unfortunately, I did not have tears of joy here. When I heard Bruce call this last little bit, and we'll go to Bruce's call, a brilliant call, we'll go to Bruce's call in a moment, I had tears of rage, Roy. Tears of rage!
I was
sobbing at the end of it. Tears of rage!
I kicked my TV in.
Did you?
I did. I kicked the bloody crap out of it.
Did you?
I did.
Just had a rage?
I said, I've had enough!
Yeah. Sandy Sunday, I've had enough here!
Yes.
Okay, let's go to Bruce's call of the closing stages of the triathlon this morning.
Well, what a surprise. Whitfield has made the most astonishing sprint, and he's celebrating. He's based on the Gold Coast. He claps three times before every race. He's going to be clapping forever now. It's Canada. What a brilliant performance. He has timed it to perfection, and Whitfield comes home. It's Simon Whitfield first, and look at Vukovic. He's got time to take the flag behind him in second place. He's celebrating a silver medal. And Rahula from the Czech Republic will get the bronze. Wow.
Did you also notice there that the German runner, the second runner, had time to grab a flag out of the crowd, waltz his way down to the line, wiping his bonds, turning around and wiggling the bot? I don't like it, Roy. I don't like it. I think if you come out here, you're just showing disrespectful not to try and post your best time, not to see the result out, not to make a dash for the line and try and snare, even though the remotest of possibilities, the bloke in front could have fallen over. Whitfield, you would have been there, gold. You know, yeah, no, it disappoints me. Yeah. It's too much showboating.
And do the Germans have a tradition of showboating? Actually,
I thought
they took things very seriously, Germans.
Well, that's the Australian.
That's the Australian. Well, he's been out here too long.
Oh, yeah, far too long.
Been out here too long. He's cocky.
Yeah.
There's nothing worse than a cocky German.
No, I take your point entirely, especially in a triathlon. At these Olympics, of course, everybody has bought a mascot, and of course, mascots are associated with the Olympics.
Sid Ollie.
Dickhead, yes. And the Dream has got its own mascot, Mr. Fatso. Here he is here. He's a chirpy old wombat. I don't know that picture does him the best, but you can see him on the screen behind him as well, behind me as well. And he's a tremendously likeable, interesting sort of wombat that trundles around doing what wombats normally do, right? You know?
He makes judgments, doesn't he?
He does.
Poor sportsmanship or appalling play.
Yes.
He'll waddle out and he lets the big ass do the talking.
Now we have one of the excitement machines, Nikolai Pendulov. And have a look at this guy's hairdo. It says it all. I'm here. I'm proud enough to wear a mullet. And if I can just keep the bar above the mullet, I think I'll be doing pretty bloody well.
He's got a beautiful technique, HG.
Look at that measured stance.
Look, he really gets to know his weights, doesn't he?
He loves his bar.
He forms a relationship with his bar. He's meticulous.
155 kgs on the bar.
He knows every millimetre of that bar.
He does. He strokes it, Roy. It's all there. He knows it. And
he's
the big problem.
He's a bar man.
Here he comes.
Okay.
150. Look at that. There it goes. Straight above the mullet.
He's got it.
And look at that mullet. Well, you could rest the bar on the mullet and it wouldn't dent it. That's Pechenov. Brilliant. Brilliant. From Croatia. Absolutely brilliant. And we hope to see more of him in this competition as he slaps the media there. And look at that coach. Don't tell me that coach isn't hiding an equally good mullet under that red and white outfit.
I mean,
he's just obviously hiding his it to reveal it another time. And now we've got from Belarus.
With your snatch, that is. And I think
we've moved on to the clean and jerk now.
Yeah.
And the
it's a prettier lift, I think, a clean and jerk.
Yes, we've got Minchev back, rather, from Bulgaria. Sorry, I just went up one division there. He's 177.5 kilograms.
He's got a post-urinal dribble there, by the looks of it. Just to the dude.
A nervous slash before he came out, Roy.
Yeah. And you can't blame him.
No, you can't.
If you've got to go, you've got to go.
Clean and jerk. There's a coach who forgot to put his teeth in this morning.
And here again you can see the great strain on the buttocks on the whole bum area.
Here it goes, going to get it up. Minchev here from Bulgaria. Yes, he can. Oh, yes, that's beautiful. That's
beautiful.
But notice how he got the bar up there and then walked underneath it. That's what I'd like to say.
Yeah.
And now he's done his knee.
He's done his knee.
What can the mullet from Croatia do?
Well, I think
this
the mullet here is going for a world record, actually.
He is. He's going for a world record, 185 kilograms.
That's an enormous amount of weight. He's going to have to get to know this bar again. Is it the same bar he was at before? Probably it is, but there might have been a bit. Oh, there's his nose-picking fingernail, which
can get in the road.
Can get in the road, I think.
Especially if you can't worry about too much out there. If the finger's going awry, the mullet's all wrong, you know. There's a top shot of a mullet, Roy.
Yes. Now, he's going to have to try and think this up, HG, because, you know, sure, the bum, we know the bum can do it, but can the mind?
Okay, here it comes.
Here it comes. Now, can he think this up?
No, he's all over the place. Look,
he's
got there. Let's have a look now.
Think it up. Come on, mullet.
Everybody at home, help.
Come on, mullet.
Up you go.
World record. Yeah. Come on, mull. Yeah. Still, he's got the gun.
The mullet there with an Olympic record, 325 in total. Sabonis,
it's the
silver, and
Angelov,
yes, the bronze.
Seven News with Lisa McCune.
Athletics legend Herb Elliott today broke his silence on what he regards as the meaning of the Olympic Games to a modern society.
That's what the Olympic Games means: love, love of people, love of spirit. It's simple. It's just love.
It's understood the IOC has declined to comment on the Elliott position.
Saddens me, Roy, to have to be the bearer of bad tidings to dream viewers everywhere. Apparently, as you point out today, the poo was hitting up with Carol Kuchera because nobody in the Australian team wanted to do it. What sort of message is this sending, Roy? As a tennis supporter yourself, as a tennis player for Australia, a former tennis player for Australia, this must, you know, be the virtue of slashing your wrists on the eve of a big competition that still is lying dormant, still there to be won. We can't count the gold in our pocket yet until we put the team on the paddock, so to speak. Mm. And with a poo not being able to find his place in the team, I mean, you saw him at the... I don't mean to go on, but can I just finish up by saying, you saw him at the opening ceremony wandering around like a brown cow. A brown cow out there, just willy-nilly, uncertain. No one wanted to talk to him. He had to go and sit in with the Greeks for a while. They kicked him out. Then, of course, he went down to the people from, I don't know, Suriname, I think, took him in the end, and mercifully showed him the way home. It was a tragedy, the opening ceremony, Roy.
Look, I know. I agree with you. I can't express my disappointment enough in what's happening in Australian tennis. And with the Olympics, actually, like the Davis Cup, it's a team event.
You forget that, don't
and
you?
And the whole idea of the Australian team is the word team. All shoulders to the one wheel. That's what it's all about. And it disappointed me that there is poor old Mark Philippoussis Pat's not talking to him, it seems.
That's our new Pat Rafter.
Pat Rafter. Little Leighton not talking to him. Andrew Lilly's not talking to him. I don't think Tony Roach is talking to him. It's very, very disappointing. And I would like to and there is a glimmer of hope, HG. You talked about the opening ceremony, where a tremendous sense of joie de vivre covered all the athletes, especially when they're all under that bloody big flag. And we noticed that Mark Woodford, the left-handed Woody, did march for a time with Mark Philippoussis. Now, maybe this is the window. If we can get Mark Woodford to get a bit of a mull together, put it in a bowl, and get Mark Philippoussis and Pat Rafter and Little Leighton and Andrew Willey around to smoke the peace pipe together, something might happen.
Yes, but where is the peace pipe?
Dream. It's a dream that could happen. I'd like it to happen here. I would love Pat to come on this program.
Well, that's your challenge, Roy.
Pat Rafter, I know you're watching the show. Come and join us. We'll get the scarred flip poo to come as well, and we'll bang your heads together.
Until you see sense.
Until you see sense. Yes. Because our tilt will not succeed unless all out of the same wheel. Can you do it? Of course you can.
Well, I'm just advising people on where to go to the different venues and where everything else is. The hardest thing I've been asked is where to find a drink of water.
And what do you tell them?
Well, I can't tell you that. I'll have to ask my supervisor, am I allowed to say it? Because the water... Come here. Am I allowed to say, I said about the drink of water. Am I allowed to say, I ask her, people ask me where to get a drink of water. Am I allowed to say that you're allowed to get it out of the toilet?
Yes, it's quite safe. It is quite safe. Yes,
what's not a problem. For it? What's the word for the water?
Eco or whatever it is. Yeah, I'm not sure, but it's fine.
So they're allowed to get a drink of water out of the toilets.
Yes.
Because
it's fine.
It's good water.
Sydney water.
Sydney water.
No problems.
Gee, I'm so relieved now that you can.
It concerns me, actually.
Well, I'm relieved that it's that good.
Yeah, I know, but I know the water out of our taps doesn't have the E. coli or Cryptosporidium or was it Guardia? That might have been the other infection we had some time ago that we don't want to tell our international guests about or international visitors to the city. But I think it's poor form if you're going to ask people to go into the toilet and start drinking out of the bowl.
Well, no, I understand
this. This is very poor counsel, I would have thought.
What I think the implications from Vi and Pam's package there was that you can drink out of the taps in the toilet, not out of the foulware, which obviously would be a bit of a challenge.
Yes, but you know how language is. You know, we went through last night how difficult it is sometimes with people whose English probably isn't as good as others.
Yes.
And you say, yeah, you can drink out of the toilet. Yeah. Go on, drink in the toilet. That's what we do here. So in they go.
Yep.
Get a bit of privacy, close the door, bend over. Next thing you know, they're...
In a hospital.
That's right.
Yeah, now look, or they've come down with gastric, which would be even worse. Now look, what the difficulty is, though, is that I think it's fair to say is the implication of Vi and Pam spray is that our toilets are as clean as those anywhere in the world.
Oh, yes. There are some countries that I wouldn't drink out of the toilets on.
Would you like to name them, Roy?
Well, just about every other country in the world.
Apart from Australia.
Apart from
That's
Australia.
My very point.
Look, I think once a toilet has been freshly cleaned...
There's no problem
there's
at all.
There's no problem at all. You can go and drink to your heart's content. Yes, just get in there.
Put the straw in.
The big straw.
Yeah. All right, another top of the cistern. You must.
Ping, pong, ping, pong, ping, pong. Ping, pong, ping, pong. Ping, pong, ping, pong, ping.
Our medal projections, HG, we've got to move on to medal projections.
What have you cooked up for us, Roy?
Well, HG, we've got based on best ever total tally. Now, in Atlanta in 1996, our total on day two was 3 medals, giving us a total at the end of that meet of 41 medals. Now, 41 if we use that projection of 3:41 ratio and have a look at what's happened here in Sydney on day two, 9 medals,
therefore,
gives us a ratio 3-41, 9 is to 123 medals.
At the end of the run. That's a tremendous result. Now, you've worked it out in another way as well. So, 123.
Yeah, in the second lot, HG, based on home ground advantage. In Helsinki in 52, we got 11 medals. In Melbourne in 56, home ground advantage, we got 35. That's roughly 3.13 times the medal count based on home ground advantage. So, if we look at Atlanta in 1996, we got 41 medals. Multiply by the same ratio of 3.18, you end up with a projection in Sydney of 130 medals, which I like. But the one I prefer is Table 3, projections based on the Aussie spirit.
Oh, yeah, now you're
in 1896, Edwin Flack was our only athlete. He got two medals.
How many athletes?
How many athletes have we got? In 2000, we've got 627, giving us a total 1 to 2 of 627 to 1,254 medals.
We're on track. Here in Sydney, apart from Martin Place, have you noticed people, you know, doing the Olympic thing out and about?
Look, the spirit has infected everyone. I think HG's infected you, me, everyone here in the audience. I mean, everyone's gone a little bit berserk. There's a sort of
full moon
effect. Lunacy from which lunacy, the word comes from the full moon, and there is a bit of a loony feel to the place at the moment. But someone described it to me as earlier in the day is it's just sick.
Sick?
Yeah.
Sick?
Yeah, it's just sick. This whole place has gone sick, someone said to me.
Did you take this as a compliment or a bit of a hindrance?
No, I thought that was great.
You were looking for vomit on the ground and stuff like that?
Yeah, well, I think that's sort of parlance for great.
Oh, great.
Right. If something's sick, mate, it's great.
Like a bit like this.
I know, it's the Germans being here or other foreigners infecting our language, but I think it's great that we've adopted sick now for, we might have... Sick Saturday next week.
Where were the origins of Sick Saturday come from?
I think Antwerp.
Look, I've got to say, right from the top of the show, isn't it great to have shooting back on the front page? It's where it belongs. I love to see big blokes who've blown off on the front page of the newspaper. Now, Roy, I must say that Michael Diamond has been a tremendous advocate for the shooting cape at the single trap event in which he won gold yesterday. But I'm just wondering if we can improve this for television, because let's face it, it doesn't really reveal the true drama on television. We've got a little bit of a footage to show you how it is covered on television now. Here's, I think, Michael with a gun in hand. Look at this. You know, it's puffs of red, pink powder, where he shoots something. There he is there. I don't know how you could improve this, but I've got a few ideas. I'm just wondering if we look at the pictures, set out rodeo clowns out there in their gaudily yellow and red costumes darting about near where the clay pellets come up and sort of distracting the shooters. That would make it a more interesting thing. Of course, they might get carried away.
With targets on their backs.
Targets on their backs. That's a very good idea. Just popping up like this.
Paintball style.
Paintball style.
Because that paintball's ready to take it off.
Yes, that's gone through
That's great fun.
But if you look at that scene there, it doesn't scream. I mean, I know you've been a very big advocate for calling shooting on radio for years and have done a lot of it. But when you look at it on television, there's not much there to look at, is there?
No. Look, I know, going back just pre-Antwerp, shooting was done with real pigeons.
Yes, I know.
And that was great. And I know Sydney and other parts of, the world really have pigeon population problems. Maybe it's an idea to bring the pigeon back.
Okay.
Or at the very least, have the clay target in the shape of a bloody pigeon.
Yes, that's right.
With a couple of feathers stuck on. So when instead of the pink powder, you actually get a bit of plumage going on.
And you had somebody in the sound box going, squawk, 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 all the time.
That's right. Oh, the other thing I like is... The other thing I like is Warrie Alderway, of course, Hayshim and myself are always up there doing a bit of pig shooting. And I think a full-on pig shoot would be a great Olympic sport.
Well, I'll tell you one other thing I think...
Because there's nothing funny than a pig but when it's shot.
No, that's right.
That's right.
That's sort of gear. But I think what we've got to do is we've got to go to those things which are bits of pests around the place. And I'm going to list two. Your Indian minor bird and your cane toad. Now, don't tell me that you couldn't get kiddies, say in the Queensland area in particular, collecting cane toads knowing there's an Olympics on, and then when Michael was shooting, they'd be fired out of the trap. Oh, you know, like this. Boom, 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 boom. Like that.
That's
you know?
Not bad. That's not bad. Because it's not much fun shooting a cane toad because they're not real quick. You know, release 20 cane toads and boom, boom, boom.
Seven News with Tanya Blenko.
This morning, Australian swimming legend Murray Rose fired a salvo at Olympic organisers.
So many of our visitors seem to be worried by our spiders. Maybe we should have a global educational campaign.
This afternoon, so-called hero Sandy Holway indicated the Rose suggestion was a potentially useful one.
I spent a bit of time at the baseball this afternoon and I just loved it. We were playing Korea and we bounced one guy there immediately, Aussie style. And we did some tremendous work actually coming home with a home run. You'll see here, bloke coming in for the home run here. Oh, Worcester! Worcester! And no.
We couldn't see that again, could
we? No, we took that Korean kitty right out.
Well, there
there we go. Let's see it in slowy. Okay, yeah, he doesn't stop you. Whack! In with the knees. Broke two of his ribs, and he's gone. He's out of it. He has to be carried off. Yeah. Whisker! Take that, buddy.
You know, in rugby league, you'd probably get 6 weeks for
that. Yeah, you would.
And in baseball.
In baseball, you get a home run. No, that's tremendous work. And that Australian style, here we go, take him off. Here we are, carried off. And
isn't it disappointing they don't have a stretcher out of the baseball or one of those little ambulances that go around that you can sit on?
No, that's right. But they're beautiful pictures. And you've got to say this Australian style of baseball is really taking off.
Did it indeed.
Can't wait till we play America.
That's right. And I think
the United States.
I tell you what, the Americans, when they see that video, will probably be, thinking about not turning up.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, that's right. Well, I think that's the whole genius of the Australian baseball style.
Yeah.
And now it's a very great thrill to welcome the captain of the Australian baseball team, Dave Neilson, to the Dream Zone.
You must be able to throw a ball like that. The World Series is played in America. How many teams play in the World Series?
Well, it's a good point, isn't it? You know, there's only two, and then they're both from America. But it starts out with.
They have a bloody stupid idea of the world.
I mean, even in World Series cricket, there are three teams.
Yeah. I mean, never mind the fact. One of them's New Zealand.
Three nations, should I say? Three nations. In America, World Series is just two teams from the same nation.
Yeah, no.
Well, that's a joke, isn't it? No, it's a joke. It's not World Series.
Well, I don't have to say anything, do I?
No, that's right. That's right. He asks the questions and often answers them, and it saves the guest a lot of embarrassment.
Yes, hello, Australia, and welcome to the women's 10-metre platform here at the Sydney Aquatic Centre. Al-Zul Almazan on the planks at the moment. A tremendous dive, degree of difficulty, 3.1. A bit of a shaky start there in the wobble as she goes up to a closed door position to begin this dive. Roy, the secret of these sort of dives is...
Well, as you've got to control it, control yourself and don't splat. And not much splat with that one. That wasn't too bad a dive at all, HG.
Here's the score. She's now moved into ranking 27th.
27th.
Now, here's a Priya.
Having trouble closing the door here, HG.
It's from Romania, and she'll need a good one.
She will need a good one after that very slow
door. She's on the way now. Oh, no,
that was a dog's breakfast, wasn't it?
It was. You know, and that terrible adjusting of the costume underwater.
Unsightly,
I don't like
it. Isn't it? Yes, it's unsightly.
If it's off, leave it off. Yeah. Now we move on to Lee Jim from Korea. Let's have a look at this. She's in trouble, Roy. Here.
Oh, no. That was a cup of hot fat with a hair in it.
It was, Roy. Oh, no, you couldn't come to Sydney for the Games of 2000. The crowd's been very, very generous.
I would give that. Oh, well, I'd give that naught.
I think the judges are failing. Yes, they are agreeing with you. Naught. Look at that. Naught. Very, very unusual.
Even the New Zealand judge gave it naught. It's telling you something.
Al-Zul Almazan back up here. Degree of difficulty 2.8. It's a beautiful dive.
Yeah, it's a simple dive. It's an elegant dive. HG.
There it is. A twist.
Twist and a
lot
nice
of splash.
Bomb.
Yeah. Oh, yes. You could satisfy a lot of Cognoscenti off the Brighton jetty with that. Mm. Now let's have a look who's up next. I think we're up to Sheni Ratna Amelia from Indonesia.
Who's
brown
eyeing the audience to begin
with. That's right. Yes, away she goes.
Oh, not a bad. Too much splat for mine.
Yes, your splat factor. In fact, she refused to step away from the abyss there,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah, here's now we've got opening brown eye with the door closed.
Angelique Rodriguez.
Opening the door slightly, well.
Completely, and then closing it. And now we're underway. Degree of difficulty 3.1 on the 10 meter. Let's have a look here. Let's She needs a score. Yes, not too bad, but a bit over-rotated, Roy.
Over-rotated and created what we call a DB, a dog's breakfast when she hit the water. It was okay till she hit the water. Lina's a wonderful diver, HG.
Yes, ranked second at the moment, and here she is. She's ready to give it her best.
Let's see the splat. No. What splat?
Yes, indeed.
That's a great example. That's copybook.
That's copybook.
That's copybook, isn't it?
It's as though the water wasn't there.
That's right.
Yeah, she just dived into thin air.
Yes, that's perfect. That's
look
close
at the scores.
Perfect.
Look at the scores there.
Yep.
And that's tremendous. And you just point out New Zealand judging up with the field. Mm. Now, Sally Freeman. Sally Freeman from Great Britain, 2.9 degree of difficulty. She's away.
This is her best dive.
Person in motion. No. No, DB.
DB.
DB with V.
Yes.
DB with V. And that means the dog's eaten the breakfast.
Vomited it up again.
That's right. And look at that very disappointing score. Sally Freeman will be very disappointed.
I preferred the dive that got naught to that
Did you, Roy? Gee, that is interesting. I think this is Papa from Greece.
Yeah. Ooh, she'll be looking forward to Athens in 4 years.
She would. Diving on home turf. Look at that.
Dog's breakfast with pike.
That is the stale pike. Oh, no, she'd be very, very disappointed with that.
See you in 4 years. Thanks for coming.
After watching last night's show, I was trying to work out a way of making TV coverage of trap shooting more interesting. Earlier in the show, there was a bit of Fatso's Mail where one viewer was wondering what happened to Sid Million Dickhead, the Olympic mascots. Where have they gone? And then, of course, I can't read it all out, he had the blinding insight of joining trap shooting to Sid Million Dickhead. So the shooters would, of course, aim at Sid Million Dickhead. Roy, this is how it would work. If you're the shooter there, just pretend you've got one here. Here they come. Here's Sidney.
Whoa, boom.
And now you've got to say pull.
Yeah, I'll pull.
Here's Millie.
Boom.
Yeah. Here's
pull.
Dickhead.
Boom.
There. That's how it would work. The variation is, of course, Sid's worth two, Millie's worth three, and Dickhead's worth five.
Well, maybe Dickhead's the one you're not allowed to shoot at, and if you do shoot at, you lose the points that you accumulated from shooting the other two. Make it hard. Make it tricky.
Now, if that's the, if people want to get in touch...
Why didn't they work? They're so cute.
I know. But look, as I keep pointing out, this just stomps all over them. That's a bloody mascot. Look at him, personality plus, hand up. It's all there on the dream. Fat ass wombat. Rules.
I'm here. I'm doing print server. I'm a print server manager. Basically, I'm in the IBC center, and yeah, having a good time. Saw a couple of athletes. It's been sick. Yeah, it's been good. This is higher than I expected. It's fully like
wow.
It's out there. You know, it's gone. Yeah.
What is?
The Olympics.
Met many people from overseas.
Yeah, heaps. French chicks. I dig them.
Yes, for a second.
You can see the French chicks would go for him, wouldn't
they? Well, especially with that sick talk. I think that's the language of love.
Fully sick, mate. Fully sick. The Olympics, fully sick.
Just wondering if it was, you know, empty sick. What would that be like?
Empty sick? That's total spew, mate.
It's total spew, right. Roy, there's two sides, I think, to any equestrian event. There's what I call the glamour side of it. And the glamour side is represented by the dressage.
Yeah.
And I think we've got a bit of overlay of dressage here that we can have a look at of horses going around doing proper things.
Yes.
Here's a beautifully turned out Australian, making the horse go sideways.
Isn't that lovely?
It's tremendous. And
it's
look
beautiful.
How silent.
Look at the control.
And the silence of the crowd, the knowledgeable crowd.
Appreciative crowd.
Thinking that Might and Power couldn't do anything like this. No. Any of Bart Cummings' horses, they'd be lost. Bart couldn't make him go sideways at all like that.
No.
And look,
well,
I've got...
There was money in it.
That's right. Look, I've got no idea of what they're scoring here. What are they judging here, Roy?
They're looking at the relationship, HG, between rider and horse, that they must move in one
move as one, I should say, with as little direction as possible from the rider. Yeah. So the perfect idea would be for the rider to just fuse and be totally still and let the horse do all the work. Yeah. And that's why this might be Andrew Hoy, I'm not too sure. But this is a marvellous performance.
Do you think that's
there.
A little dull, Roy?
No, well... Yes. But for those who appreciate it,
I mean,
the
if
horse,
I put this on my head like this, I don't know whether I can do this,
yeah.
And just wandered around, you know, yeah. Clippity-clop, 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 do you think people would pay $45 a session to see me?
No. No, I don't think they would. No. But if you could train a cat to sit on your head, totally still, or a wombat, yeah, that's right. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. And if the... That's not bad. But if you could get a live wombat and sit it on your head and make the wombat get you to do what it wanted you to do, that'd be worth seeing.
Yes, that certainly would.
I want you to dig a hole. Keep digging. Keep digging.
Very big welcome to the Dream Dome, the House of Zeds, to Australia's captain in basketball, Michelle Timms.
I believe that the Opals had lunch with the Pooh, Mark Philippoussis, recently.
Yes.
Now, we're trying to get a campaign going to have he and Pat smoke the peace pipe, and we have this here as a symbol. We've got the racket and the peace pipe here. Do you think it's possible that could happen, that he and Pat and the Woodies
The body language and everything at the village, and sure, everybody knows about what's happened in the past and that, so everyone's sort of checking them out to see if there's any, you know, rivalry or, you know, discontent between them. But Philippoussis has been a lovely guy. He's one of my favourites on the campus. He's been really, really good, really cheery, talking to everybody, and came and sat with the Opals for lunch today. And, you know, I mean, we don't know as outsiders what's been going on and what actually, you know, you media guys are all like, you like to blow everything out of proportion.
Well, so, we don't. We're trying to put it in perspective. We just want them to get together and smoke the peace pipe.
Sure, they'd probably really like to do that, actually. I'm not sure. But I could see it probably happening. I think that if it would happen, it would happen on this show, though.
Now, Mayor Richardson over at the village there, you may not know this, has 100,000 condoms on tap for, obviously, you know, romances that will develop in the village. Do you think he's got too few? I mean, I'm worried that he hasn't worked this through because, you know, it's 15 days, say, most people would spend in the village. 100,000 and he's got 10,000 athletes. Well, just do the maths there yourself. I mean, he's just... totally going to be totally run out probably by about Friday. The other thing I wanted to ask was, you know, you may not know the answer to this, but do you have to go and see Graham personally for the condoms?
Oh, actually, I don't know. I've heard a lot of stories about the Cubans, though. The Cubans are going through them like they're going out of fashion. The strawberry-flavoured ones, they're really been getting into them. And they've got a bit of a mafia thing going with the old condoms, so I think the Cubans are winning that race. They're winning
cornered the market. Yes, that's right.
He's pretty much time with you know...
The Cubans?
No, not so much the Cubans.
Can see the velodrome, and I used to be able to watch the events, but now I can't because they've got the blinds on. And when they used to go up really high, you could see them like racing, and used to see them when they won something. They used to always go like that, so you used to always be able to see it. But now they always keep the lights on until like 6, and it's hard to sleep. So that's the bad thing about living across the road from there.
Yes, now look, the Fatso, the fat-ass wombat's had an enormous day. He's been allowed out of the House of Zeds, the Dream Dome.
and he's been bobbing up everywhere. Have a look at this at the pool tonight at the medal celebration.
There
look at what Michael Klim's holding. He's covered up by the flag, but there he is. There's Fatso, the big ass wonder.
And the Prime Minister wasn't all that happy to see Fatso, the big ass wombat there.
Out and about. And clearly looks very relaxed carrying a wombat under his arm there. And I think there's a little bit more there. He's been shown to the crowd and getting a lot of cross-promotional work. He goes everywhere. He's working for charity. He's doing things that other, like those other mascots, those yellow kangaroos look bloody ordinary, don't they, Roy? In
they
there.
Do. They do. And I tell you, who does come out of this pretty ordinarily, Ashton, that's Sid, Ollie and Buddy Dickhead.
Now, look, the sad news is, and we haven't dwelt on the New Zealand tilt here in Sydney nearly enough, Roy is a Kiwi freak. He just loves everything to do with New Zealand because he loves bagging it. And Roy, take us through the tilt so far. And when you've done your tilt, just let Australia know the medal tally for New Zealand.
Yeah, I will, actually. I'll just keep that powder dry for a moment. New Zealand has had a run of outs. We can have a look at a little bit of New Zealand in action here. I think we start off with the New Zealand softball team, HG. And it's just come off the rails, the whole thing. Here we go. A strike, a trip. The shoelaces are undone. It's bloody hard to do them up when you've got the silly gloves on that don't really fit and the tongue's getting in the way. It's just been an absolute bloody disaster for New Zealand. And this was the high point for them, actually. Here we see the New Zealand in the white here going left to right. Looks like the full court press from Korea has worked its magic on New Zealand. Here they're working the ball around and it just falls away from them again. And we do see one of the New Zealanders, one of their crack New Zealanders actually going for we see the layout here, very easy, making the New Zealand look very, very ordinary.
Here we go.
Here's a penalty shot, HG. Look at this. Put it in. Yeah. I hate to say it, but... that's how it's been for New Zealand from start to bloody finish. And their highlights they're seeing over in, you know, Auckland. I mean, we can dwell on our, you know, Klimi and the whole tremendous relay team, and we've got Susie and we've got, you know, our equestrians. We can celebrate a lot of our, but poor on New Zealand, all they've got to look at is tragedy, travesty and sadness. And the other thing is actually their training secrets are being stolen.
Yes.
All their computers, not that there were many secrets there.
Yes.
I got a copy of the New Zealand training secrets here, HG.
Have you?
That makes very interesting reading.
Oh, for sure.
Team secrets, okay. Number one, don't think like a New Zealander. Number two, when speaking to an Australian, deny you are a New Zealander. For swimmers, one, don't swim on a full stomach. That makes sense. Two, if you get to the front, try to stay there. Number three, try to have a good long sleep before you swim. Athletics, one, see point two for swimmers. If you get to the front, try to stay there. Two, try your hardest. Three, if you are interviewed, don't embarrass yourself.
Well, they've thought it through, Roy.
Haven't they thought it through?
And I must say, right from the top, they're very disappointed because apparently the computers have been stolen from the Nissen Hutton, the village where they had them set up, and people were working on them. Mm. And unfortunately, the only thing they can think of, it's an inside job, because no one else is allowed in there. And so some New Zealanders walked off with those secrets, unless it's one of the
and giving them to us.
That's right. Unless it's one of the bogus thoughts in the village.
Yeah.
This is one of the
security has been a problem in the village, hasn't it?
It has, a total problem.
I saw about 8 Ian Thorpes this afternoon. And only one of them looked like him.
Well,
and he was in the pool.
A lot of them look better than the real Ian Thorpe, too.
Yeah, much more impressive.
Much more convincing.
And swim faster, too.
A lot faster. Now, Roy, that medal tally that you were going to keep your
powder dry. New Zealand, yes. Let's have a look at their medal tally. Here it is. I'll give you a New Zealand graphic. This is the way they do it in New Zealand. And here is our tally.
Yes, Welcome to Sydney Aquatic Centre, where we've got heat one of the 100 metres freestyle. Three tremendous competitors we've got from Equatorial Guinea in lane three, Eric Musambani. In lane four from Nigeria, Kirin Barre. And finally in lane five from Tajikistan, Farouk Oripov. As we see now, the competitors are taking their blocks. Could be a very, very competitive heat. I like the look of Musambani. I saw him in training midweek, and gee, he can really put it together. There's only three in this heat one. Other lanes have been sadly decimated by scratchings. Did you hear the get set there, Roy? I don't think I heard anything.
Yes, I thought I did. I agreed with, because these blokes are out as far as we know. That's it.
Barre and Oripov. Yeah,
and Oripov. I think they're gone.
They could be gone. We might have a sensation here at the Aquatic Centre, because heat one of the 100 metres freestyle has suddenly been reduced to a swimmer of one.
They don't know it yet, actually. But I mean, they've spent money on this new Speedo equipment. And they're not cheap, those suits.
They're not. And they now, unfortunately, Musambani thinks he's been out of it. But now, as the officials gather, this is officialdom gone berserk here at the Sydney Aquatic Centre. Why not give the kids from Tajikistan and Nigeria a go? So, and now we have the farce of Musambani trying to qualify from Equatorial Guinea in heat one of the 100 metres free. Roy, take us through.
Okay, off he goes. Let's see what his style is like.
He's looking very, very good.
He's, from my age, he's going out
a bit too hard.
He might struggle a little bit in the last 25. I don't know. He's thrashing about there.
An egg-beater. Listen, the heat one has been robbed of a lot of its glamour and interest with the scratches of Barre and Oripov. Roy?
But I tell you what I like about the bloke. He likes to put his head up and have a look where the end of the lane is, where the block is at the other end, because you don't want to bang your head or anything like that.
Equatorial Guinea has no swimming pools, and so it's probably wise to look for the end of the lane here. That's and you'll right. notice the camera
look
at the
at
bottom
his double
of the
turn,
Let's have a look at this. Yes.
A little bit slow, but he's got the right idea.
He's got the mechanics of it down, Roy. And this is the Olympic spirit writ large here at the Sydney Aquatic Centre this morning in heat one of the 100 metres free, as we see a one-competitor race. Sole competitor from Equatorial Guinea, Eric Musambani. Roy, bring it home. Bring the boy home, Roy.
It's only the clock he's beating now, HG.
Let's see if he can get a record.
Let's see if he can get a record. Now, we know the world record's about 48 seconds. Is there something like that?
Correct.
He's up to 107. We thought he'd struggle in the last half of the second lap, HG, and he is.
Come on, Eric. He's got a chance to get the Equatorial Guinea record, though, and I think he's right on target for the Equatorial Guinea
what
record.
What is the Equatorial
History
Guinea record,
in the making.
It's about 151?
153, I think, Roy. 153. 80, which Eric holds. Here's a very big chance. He's got a very big chance to go under the Equatorial Guinea record.
Come on, Eric.
Heat one of the 100 metres free here at the Sydney.
Come on, Eric, put in.
A lot of support here today. Go, Eric.
Go, Eric. Eric, bring it in.
Equatorial Guinea record for the 100 metres freestyle. And believe you me, Roy, you will remember that long after you've forgotten everything else about the Sydney Olympics.
That
was a genuine highlight. I can look at it all again right now. I know.
But the thing is, how many young kids now in Equatorial Guinea
will be doing it?
We're thinking 100 metres, I might get into that.
That's right. They appear to give anybody who turns up a go.
That's right.
When your heart is jumping at you're toeing the mark, you know you're the best in the park. Now get set for the starter's gun, get ready to run. Give just a little bit more, just a little bit more. Take it right down to the wire. You're on fire, you're on fire. When your heart is pumping as you run down the track, to the test, you may think that you've done your best. Give just a little bit more, just a little bit more. Take it right down to the wire. You're on fire, you're on fire. When you hear the roar as you enter the street, make you run out
Roy, look, there's a protocol problem has erupted at the Games. Apparently someone's touched up the Princess Royal, Princess Anne. She was out of the hockey, and she didn't even notice it. She didn't even notice it. But a royal official noticed that a hand did come over here and slide down the back very, very slowly like that. And mercifully, officials did ask people to apologise on behalf of Australia. Now, I think, Roy, you are prepared to apologise on behalf of the nation.
Yes, I would. I would. Yes, Your Royal Highness, on behalf of everyone Antipodean, which includes our New Zealand brothers and sisters, and all in the Pacific Rim, I apologise to you for any inconvenience that might have been caused given the occasion of someone, a male person, each bloke, i.e. Australian bloke, going up to you and giving you a bit of a touch around the date.
Yes, welcome to the Convention Centre, Darling Harbour, where we've got women's weightlifting underway, 69-kilogram class, and first out in the snatch, Michelle Kentner dressing the bar at 100 kilograms. Roy, it's been an exciting evening of weightlifting here at the Convention Centre, and Michelle has thrilled us, hasn't she?
She has. She loves her lifting. She just glows with the joy of throwing a weight into the air. And from memory, she's got interesting sponsorship too.
We'll have a look now. Yes. If we can get the shot, yeah, yes.
She's got two companies there that normally don't sit side by side.
And, of course, unfortunately, Bob, the cameraman, and his offside Joe, as we watch Michelle get it up.
She's loving this.
And look at the tongue. The tongue's holding it up there. And she drops it away. And keep watching the tongue, ladies and gentlemen. It does have a life of its own. It's a great personality tongue.
That's a great lift. 100 kilos, that's it.
100 kilos. And, of course, Steve, her husband's here. They're always, there's the tongue out again. And directed at Steve, of course. And
Steve was a great lifter himself.
He was. I think it's your Olympian, yes, Steve. So, yeah. And here we see him replay. Let's hope we can get it up here. Tremendous, yes, effort by Michelle. Effort.
And here's where the joy begins, because she knows she's got it.
There's the tongue. And on she goes. And again. And what I was going to say about Joe, the cameraman today, is he's got a foot fetish.
He does.
And we do apologise in advance for any problems that Joe's foot shots may cause in the community. Fark Sufo out now. And this is
the Thai girl. She doesn't muck about, does she?
She gets on with the job. 105 kilograms on the bar, her third attempt at this, an exciting competition. And Fark Sufo has kept us enthralled with the Thai style. Have a look at this for a little bit of
for a lift.
There we go. There
we go. Oh dear, that can happen. You've really got to be careful, as you, once you've got it, near the head or just above the head, get your head out of the way if you're going to go. And here's
the world record.
Yeah, Marcus. We should see the Marcus stomp here, HG. She's known for the stomp she gives. This is the Hungarian.
112.5 kilograms on the bar. Let's have a look here.
Marcus stomp.
I wonder if Joe collects these pictures of feet and has fun with them afterwards.
I suppose he does, HG. I suppose he does. And hasn't this become really a tremendous event now for both men and women in weightlifting now that it's clean?
Yeah, now that they've cleaned it up entirely and just rely on the footwear for the support. Yeah. Here we go, Mark. Oh, look at that, Roy. Just beautifully. And takes a few steps towards the audience, just doing threatening.
That's right.
Just I'm here, you're there. So if you don't look out, I'll throw it at you. 112.5 kilograms on the bar. A tremendous lift from, let's see.
That was Marcus, actually.
Marcus of Hungary. Fark Sufo now out again, and 127.5 kilograms. This the excitement machine from Chiang Mai here. The Chiang Mai chopper. Look, I think she's in a bit of trouble.
No,
the clean's okay. Let's have a look at what happens next.
Yeah,
I think it.
Here we go. Now, she has been known to intimidate judges by coming
forward. Yes, here she comes. Here she comes.
Oh,
here she comes. She's going to get one. Yes, just dropped in the notch of time, I'd say.
Yes, let's have a look at this. I apologise to the judges for the threatening behaviour.
Yeah, and this is interesting, Wayne Ng from China. Have a look at this, Roy. The coach
is winning, HG, and she'll be going for gold.
Now, the coach explains the art.
Lifted up.
That's right. Bar up. Not underneath, but bar up. He doesn't think he's got the message through.
By the way, lift the bar up. Don't forget to have it in your hand. Don't just raise your hands. Pat, make sure there's something in them. Yep, I got it. Understand.
Okay.
Lift bar. Okay. That's right. Bar, that's right.
Yeah, then we're off to the Imperial Peking afterwards.
Yeah. Now, after you lift the bar.
That's right.
With the weights.
Is that right?
And I think you mean the bar with the weights over there? Yes.
There's a hold up here because she wants to go for 132.5 kilograms and they haven't got the Socog helpers here, volunteers, are out at lunch, unable to get this bar set, and she's keen. She's ready to go. She's ready to rock and roll.
This is disgraceful.
It is absolutely appalling. People are there ready to lift, ready to come
she's
out.
She's ready to go. Put on gold a medal for a gold medal.
Gold medal, yes. That's right. She's ready to put on a display for Australia. 69 kilogram class, 132.5, just double her weight on the bar there. And she's ready to rock and roll, and we haven't got the bar ready. I do notice the right hand side looks a lot thicker than the left hand side. If you look at those pictures there of that bar, worrying me. Yeah. There's the foot shot. Thanks, Joe.
Okay, this is for the gold medal, HG. The gold medal. This is gold.
In 69 kilogram class.
Good luck. There's the clean. A good clean.
Yes.
Nice clean. Steady clean.
Can she jerk the jerk? Let's have a look at this.
Good luck.
There.
I think she's got
She's very, very steady. Tremendous.
Oh, you could have put a house on top of that. She would have got it.
She would have handled it with these, Roy. Handle it with these.
Yeah, well, she remembered the coach's instructions paid off because often she'll go out there and just. Put her hands in the air and come on.
Off to the applause of the crowd.
This comes from Michelle and Jody of Brisbane. Mm. We're interested in finding out if weightlifters suffer from hemorrhoids. We both thought due to the great strain placed on that part of the anatomy, they must. Look, I don't know if they do.
No. Aren't they fit and have the blood circulating properly?
Yeah, I think they do. I think hemorrhoids is more a golfer's ailment, isn't it? Not sure. I know more golfers that have hemorrhoids than weightlifters. Well, I know more golfers than weightlifters.
And we only know one real golfer who's got them, and that's the shark.
That's right.
You know, it's a very small sample. The shark's hemorrhoids problem. I mean, he's blamed 3 or 4 major losses on the hemorrhoids. He's used up all the other excuses for mine. Hemorrhoids. God, it's a fine excuse, isn't it? How's it going today, Sharky? Okay. No, bro, the hemorrhoids were playing up. Missed that putt on the last. I mean, to make the cut, that is. Look, archery. I've got a Phil Turnbull's written an email. He says, archery fashion, no thought at all, as far as I can see. I haven't read that quite right. Archery fashion, / no thought at all, as far as I can see. And he's absolutely right. Our gold medal winner. I looked like he'd just come out of the smart casual Friday at work. You know how they have smart casual funny hat days.
The uniforms, the artists,
they do.
Haven't they?
They should
be like in Lincoln Green with a quiver.
And one of those hats. hats. And get rid of that shoulder stuff, which makes them look
all
as though
wrong.
They're trying.
Yeah.
And if they want to split their nose, really split their nose. Put a great cleaver in there, cleft in there, so it's when they come like this, it's got a notch there, and the fancy ones will be able to just like that and let the arrow go out of the nose.
That's right. So I was still with the shark's grapes.
And the good news from the world of archery is that the Aussie tilt for gold, Simon Fairweather, is right on track here at the archery. It's down to Simon Fairweather from Australia. He started competing at the age of 6 months up against the power and might of Vic Wunderlee from Milwaukee in the United States. And the crowd right behind the card table here, the dream card table here, is getting the chant going that we will hope will bring Simon Fairweather home.
The idea, I think, as I understand, is to get that arrow as close as possible to the centre of the board.
Is that right? It's as simple as that.
And that's not a bad bloody shot.
Yes, the crowd.
There's a series of concentric rings. The centre of the board is your
that black dot.
That black dot right in the middle. That's where you'd want to be aiming for.
Look at that. That's better.
That's not bad. He's back on. He's on song now, isn't he? And there are his parents, of course, come all the way
from Milwaukee. And here's Simon Fairweather, the Australian, who was born, I think, in South Australia, now lives in Belconnen in the ACT.
All right.
So he's.
That's a great shot.
If he can hold on, Roy, he might be the first South Australian to bring home gold in the 2000.
In the 2000 games, you're right, actually, because South Australia haven't really put in much to our games to as yet. Wunderlee now.
Very, very talkative off the shooting range, but on the range, quiet as a mouse, Roy. And now I think we move on to the next phase of the competition where they actually move rather closer to the
Move it up a little bit,
just to keep them honest, as you were pointing out.
Yeah.
Now, Roy,
both of them like to take a bead right down the centre of their nose. As I understand it, the idea is to split your nose with the string to get absolute accuracy.
There
That's
he is
not
now.
Bad. He's splitting his nose nicely. And
Lets it go. Yes,
that's
good
nice.
One.
I will notice with the Wonderly fellow, HG, I think he's been doing it for a little bit longer than Simon because he's actually got a split all the time down his nose now from this continual rubbing of the string.
And I tell you one thing as we watch Wonderly on screen now, I tell you one thing, don't tell me good shot from Wonderly there, the Milwaukee madman here shooting for gold in the Olympics. Roy, one thing that this is going to get kids tomorrow morning, they'll be getting bits of bamboo, tying string to it, and getting other bits of bamboo and firing it at their brothers and sisters and the kids from next door. It's got to be good for the sport of archery. This put archery right back on the map, and I've got to say, hats off. If fair enough, I think he's got it, Roy.
I think he's got it.
The crowd knows he's got it, too. Count down another gold, Roy, here for Australia as we see.
This will have to be some bloody shot here from Wonderly.
As we see Wonderly wilting at the archery range. Look at that nose. The nose isn't working. He's got it all wrong. Look, exactly. He gets 9 for that. It's bopped up too much on one side there, Roy.
Yes, he didn't accommodate, make adjustments or allowances for the wind, did he?
No, it was blowing his face around.
Simon is a wind master.
Smooth as a cuke. Cool as a cuke. He's outclassing the kick.
He really stuck it, didn't he? Stuck it.
The Milwaukee madman knows he's got a fight on his hands here. And I think that, I'm marking this down as gold to Australia, Roy. I don't know how you're seeing it.
I'm seeing it that way.
I mean, I think they should invoke the mercy rule here, Roy. I mean, the Wonderly's totally outclassed. Here in the archery.
Even his string's fraying now from running against his nose.
Yeah. Oh, well, he gets 9 there. He's a bit of respect there. Oh, yeah, no.
He's checking again in the telescope to see how close he is. Not close enough would be my answer, Vic.
Now, Roy, I think that the...
Simon's not happy. I don't think he's been given the go ahead. Yeah, he's been given the go ahead now.
And the crowd want him to push on for gold.
Come on, Simon, bring it home. They're shouting. It doesn't put him off, though.
No.
And archers like it raucous, don't they?
Yes, they do. There.
Oh, it's a bit wobbly.
That might be enough. I don't think he can be beaten now.
No, he can't.
I don't think he can be beaten now. And the great Simon Fairweather, originally of South Australia, and everybody in South Australia, stand up and take a bow. And this is tremendous here as we see Simon Fairweather on the dais in the individual gold in the games of the 27th Olympiad. Congratulations, Simon. Stand up and take a bow, South Australia.
Yes, hearts of gold, HG. A number of people, enthusiastic Australians who love Australia and love the Olympics, wrote songs that they hoped would have been used by Rick Birch and Johnny Farnham and the whole team, so that you would have had the singers on the opening ceremony singing that instead of the Flame, for example, singing one of their songs.
Yes,
Well, unfortunately, the team at Rick Birch's mob decided they wouldn't go with these. So these are rejects. But we think they've got qualities, endearing and redeeming qualities about them that are worth sharing with all of Australia.
We have stability and the facilities, plus the administrative skills. We have the climate and the people who love the sporting thrills. Australia will make you welcome, and you'll be glad you came for Sydney's presentation of the next Olympic Games. We can do it again, much the same as before, just like it was then. Bring the games to our shore with our hearts and minds raised to the task that lies ahead. The same as 56, Sydney has the mix to bring the Olympics to our door. We can do it again if we all work as one and never slow until the job is done. The Olympic torch and the Southern Cross will light our way. With blue Australian skies, there'll be no surprise. You'll see the Olympics at our door. What kind of place is Australia? This land of
equity. This land of today and tomorrow, a place of diversity. What kind of city is Sydney? What brings life to her street? This city of her dedication, with a heart and pulse that beats. We can do it again if we plan it, we're bold, and shoulder the load for the green and the gold. The Olympic flame will be seen on high again. The flags will be unfurled when Sydney has the world at our door for the great Olympic Games.
I think this is the only show that's prepared to go to the fencing. A lot of people say it's too hard to call. Roy and I don't agree. We love to see people, obviously it's on record, we love boxing. We love to see people with bloody big things between them and an opponent whacking away at each other just as much. Never mind the gloves, if they've got a sword in their hand, if they've got a dagger, if they've got a bit of a cutlass.
Yeah, a club.
A club, if they've got a mace, or if they've got a ball on a chain. We love it, we think that's all great.
A broken beer glass.
Right, today we were lucky enough to get out to the EP team, Roy.
The FA.
Now, Roy, fencing, what's the skill, what's the art, what's
well, it
the
comes
craft?
From, it comes from people wanting to kill each other.
Does it, Roy?
It does. With a very thin piece of steel.
Yes.
Which you would drive through the body at any angle you like and hopefully sneaking or going right through
a vital organ.
The aorta.
Oh, is that what it is?
The aorta. Yeah.
I had no idea, go for
the aorta.
Exactly.
Because that will snuff you out very, very quickly indeed. And so this is now formalised. They see that we're plates over here so that obviously, and a bit of a knob on the end of the epa. Yeah. So the idea is to do a little bit of this stuff.
Yeah. And then have a go. Now, the scoring.
Just
will you explain
like
the scoring?
Scoring. Well, if I hit you, I get a point.
Yeah, and how do you get that registered?
Well, there's an electronic device here which engages on when it has contact with the plate, it'll go...
That's right.
And you look up to see who's hit whom, and if the light's on your side, you beauty.
Yeah.
If the light's on the other side, you've got a thing here.
Yes.
Bad luck.
So don't be surprised if you see a sort of rat's tail leaving the fencer. It's meant to be there. It's the contact with the scoring system.
Yeah.
Now,
it comes out the back door.
That's right. You know, they've just inserted
which
something
out
the back door.
Which is a little bit unsightly for mine.
Well, yeah.
There's no need to have it come out that area. The Princess Anne area of the...
Now, Italy won in Atlanta in a spiteful final, which was temporarily halted to clear the blood out of the eyes of one of Italy's opponents.
Oh, yeah.
I wonder if history will repeat itself. Let's go to the AP final, team final, right now.
Yes, welcome to the exhibition hall. We're going for gold. We've got France for Italy in the men's AP, the team. We've got Cires Obre on one side here, on the left-hand side, and Maurizio Randazzo on the right. And I think the first blade goes to Randazzo, Roy. Look, he's very excited.
He's fired up, isn't he?
It's an Italian expression of, I got you, you fruit. I think that's what he's saying. Is that fair?
So. That's basically it, I think. Actually, we can see the touch.
There, the shoulder.
Oh,
yeah. Yes, you can see that. Take that, you French
fruit. I got him twice. Ha-ha, I got him twice.
And I think we go to the next round after the view of the judge here, who looks very, very patient. And Cires Obre is up
Randazzo.
Again. And Randazzo again. Yes, this very exciting men's team FA going for gold. France v Italy, the old foes.
Yes,
Napoleon.
You've just got to stab him, HG, anywhere on the chest or
just
head.
Get him.
Get him.
We've got Obre on left of screen, Randazzo on the right. It's a beautiful...
Ooh, tried to toe him. Get him on the toe.
Tense here. Beautiful high-class fencing. This high-class, the EP, I love it.
Click stuff that we, you know, see in films. I mean, this is what it's really like.
Yeah,
you just want to stab a bloke.
That's right, this is really how to kill someone.
You don't want to hit his sword. You want to hit him?
Yeah, that's right.
There!
Oh! Yes. I think the French got that one.
He likes it.
Look at the emotion. And the Randazzo giving him the thumbs up.
Aubrey, he gets fired up, doesn't he?
Yes, he does.
He just said sort of, oh!
Hey. And let's have a look at this replay. Here we see. There.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yes, and then the big eye.
That's right. And now we move on
we move on. This is the King of Port here on the left.
On the left, yes.
And have a look at this. Come get me, fella, if you're good enough. Yeah, that's what he's saying. Yeah, I can lie down. I lie down on the ground. You walk along. And this is Di Martino from France on the right, and he seems to be in
the game. Look at this, no, he's not ready. Oh, something's annoying him. It's too loud.
Must be a fly in his bonds.
No, get the, he wants the crowd quiet.
It's Randazzo causing the Guy D's kicking it forward.
Now the referee's laying down the law. Listen to me, you dickhead. Get on with it.
That's right. Here we've got Manalo on the left, and I missed up who's on the right there, Roy. Is that
Frenchman, I think.
Shrekky,
Yeah, Shrekky. Yeah, it looks like Shrekky.
Look at that Manalo there. Beautiful.
Look at that bounce. Take that. Yes.
And the scores at the moment are Italy 36. Yes, Italy 36, France 8. 38.
Benny's foil, his Epe, as you went into
as we go in here, let's have a look. Where is it?
Yep, there it is, right in the throat.
Yes, and he killed that fly that was mozzing him earlier in the day. Now there's trouble here with the sword.
Well, he picks his sword, Ben, I think that's true. I think he's Pidoli, is it? Yeah, he's always bunging something on.
He's always playing for time, but he hates fighting. Just get on with it, bro.
And he's getting a yellow card.
He's got the card. No surprises there, Roy. The card's out of the pocket. And he's cross. He's not happy, Roy.
You've got to wear it, fella. Yeah. If you're get a dickhead, that's right. Be philosophical. If you're a dickhead, you get a yellow card.
Shrekky back on the planks now on the right-hand side. And, of course, Italy on the left there. And this is the King of Four here for Italy.
He'll bounce back. He'll go back the other side, actually, and call him down.
Yes, he will. This is it.
Oh, no. He's calling him down.
Come up here, bro.
Yeah, come on.
Shrekky got him there.
Oh, no, I think his foil went into his... the guard went into his helmet, into his face. It's hurt his nose. It's busted his nose. Something else on slow motion.
Tragedy here. Straight in. It's the pommel or whatever.
The guard.
The guard. Just cracked him on the head.
Cracked him on the nose, on the bridge of the nose. And that can hurt, you know.
It can, especially if you've got that fly screen between you and it. We're back live. That's France on the right, Italy on the left. And here we see.
Yes, he doesn't believe it, but he did it.
He's done it. Here come the rest of the team members until he's taken it. Italy's taken it 39-38 in the final round of the Team Zeppe. Gold goes to Italy in controversial circumstances. The team is up. They're enjoying this moment in the sun, Roy.
And Aubrey, he is devastated. Aubrey is devastated. I mean, we've known Aubrey for a hell of a long time. I've never seen him that upset.
Here we go. Let's have a look at it here. 1 point in it.
That's it.
Look at me. I've done it.
Cool as a cuke.
King of Hort. That's Alfredo Rota from Italy there. 39 points to Aubrey, who only managed to 38 in the final of the team's event, as the team comes from everywhere there. And, of course, Italy can laugh. And unfortunately, unconsolable. Unconsolable. Oh, God. And here's the medal presentation. And he's an interesting bloke in the middle here. He looks very, very authoritative.
Oh, they're very proud of that. They've a big goal.
Tremendous epic final here. Little touch there from Rota. Very, very funny. Italy gold, France silver, and Cuba bronze. You've got some footage here. I think it's a Russian coach in a break in a volleyball game in Russia.
Yeah.
Russia versus Cuba. And you've done some work trying to understand what this coach is on about. Let's have a look at him now.
Let's have a look at him, mate. He's an interesting bloke.
Yes, wow. Two things I'd like to point out about that clip is not only the ferocity of the coach, which you might be able to address, but the very severe woman standing alongside him. I don't know whether you glimpsed her with the red hair and the rather
stern
look about her. And there seemed to be a ring-in in the team who was wearing an entirely different uniform.
That's right.
I take it was some sort of, designated puncher. Roy, what was he trying to get? What message was he trying to get?
I think you can divine. I think he was saying, look at me, listen to me.
Yeah.
You're making me look a goose, a dog, a fool, an idiot. Do you think I've come all this way to look like this? Listen to me. You're making me look an idiot.
Yeah, right.
I'm going to have your family killed.
Yeah.
7 News with Sophie Faulkner.
This morning, popular swimming hero Eric Mizumbini declared his fondness for Sydney, the dream, and Fatso, the fat-ass wombat, and why wouldn't you?
I love the dream, I love Sydney, and I love Fatso.
We have had, as people will know, a medal stripped from a weightlifter in the 56-kilogram class, Ivan Ivanov. There's something weird about his name. I can't quite work out what it is.
Well, if you think, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Ivanov would call him something else than like, other than Ivan.
Like Dick Ivanov.
Yeah, yes, Dick Ivanov. Yeah.
Anyway,
that's a different matter.
Now, we 56-kilogram class. I think the team are appealing this decision.
They are.
But we conducted some interesting research, didn't we, Roy?
We did, actually. We revisited our call of Ivan Ivanov. To see if we could see any telltale signs. Mm. And this is what we saw.
Here he comes out again for his, I think he's on the...
Oh, he's really wide now, isn't he?
He's on the front. Yeah.
And yet, when we looked at this the other night, he looked like all the others.
Yeah, have a look at this. That's right, that's the thing that surprised me. He's rubbing his hands in that white
powder. We can't wait to get going.
He's rubbing his hands in that white powder. I don't know what it is. I'm very suspicious when I looked in that bowl. Oh, he's touching himself.
Well, what was that? What was that? The ears? The butt?
Dr. Spock.
Looks as if he's pointing north too, HG, oddly enough.
Well, that can happen too. Let's see how he goes here. Look, he dwells over the bar. At least, unlike some, he remembers to lift it.
Yeah, that's
true.
You've
got to get him that.
That's true.
Unlike others we've called in this way.
Yeah, it looks like Barry Unsworth looking at him there between the legs.
Barry, no stranger to weightlifting and fitness himself.
Here talking again.
Talking to people who aren't there.
No.
Now.
Here it is, a bloke pumped.
Up he goes,
yeah. Yeah. Look at that definition of the muscles there, actually. I mean,
look at this. Look at this. Short side.
High as a kite.
On something, yeah.
High as a kite.
He's in love with a bar.
Oh, he's dancing now.
Yeah, that's right. He's got to walk.
Oh, he's going to walk on the wall.
Look. Over the moon, dream come true.
Yeah. Oh, no, he's going to take a dump there on the top of the steps.
Oh, that weird T-sign.
The T-sign.
That's right, that must mean something to somebody, but not now he's going to throw his shoes off. Oh, no, end of the bloke's hand.
Whoa! Yes, interesting. Well, I think there we rest our case.
Kingsley Drew just said, send us an email because he'd like a mention on television. I don't care, what you...
Kingsley Drew?
Yeah, Kingsley Drew.
Kingsley
doesn't
Drew.
Care what we say, just say anything.
Kingsley Drew.
There you go.
Well, wouldn't it be great if Kingsley Drew and Fatso could be part of the closing ceremony?
Why not? And, of course, I think Drew rhymes with poo, so he could be involved in the Pat Rafter selection as well.
Joe Buckner has never been beaten. A heavyweight pie is now all he's eaten.
He can count to 10 and back again.
So Australia's in heaven now that I see Joe.
Yes, welcome to Darling Harbour Exhibition Halls for the men's 54-kilogram. We're into round two now with Chottapat Bonaparte on screen now in the blue from Thailand up against our very own Justin Cain in the red. What about this has been Chottapat Bonaparte's on top at the moment, and I think now as the referee separates them and asks them to re-box, we might go down to ask Joe, what does Justin have to do now?
No, Justin's got to throw straight punches in combinations. Threes and fours, straight punches. Southpaws can't get away from those.
Yes, insightful comments from Aussie Joe Buckner, the Senior 7 boxing commentator. Now Kane's on top here against Chottapat Bonaparte from the Thailand. And I think this could be the fifth boxing victory here at the exhibition halls at Darling Harbour in the games for the Australian boxing team. And Justin Kane at the break there is now 10 points to 6 in the lead.
I was going to say, actually, if Joe was still about, I'd put to Joe the thesis that it seems to me he seems a lot better using both hands. Juan Prade seems to be more left-handed than right, and the two-hand combination seemed to work well for him. What do you think, Joe? If you want to comment.
Yes, he's throwing the left-right, left-right. One of them always lands.
Yeah, well, that's true, Joe, but can you tell us a bit about southpaws?
Southpaws have an inability to block left-rights, because they just don't know which way to turn left or right, or move which way left or right.
Right.
Right. Well, that is interesting.
He makes it seem so simple as we go into the fourth round now with a minute 52 left on the clock here, and Kane's taken right up to Chodipatwan Prades from Thailand, and it's over this. Remember, this is the referee breaks into the fight now briefly here. This is one for the fans. This is one for the people of Australia who bought the get down at Darling Harbour, and look at some first-class Australian young people, youth of the world, making friends. Couple of low blows there from Keynes, but I don't think it's going to hold him up now. It's gone out to 11-6. It's blown out, and I think the referee steps in and wisely cautions the Australian boy about belting people in the cruets. But there's nothing wrong with that if you can get away with it.
If you get away with it, do it. That's what I know. That's what Joe used to do.
And if you can get a swelling downstairs, there's nothing wrong with that, and a swelling upstairs to match it, as we see Justin Kane pushing on now. And beautiful shorts.
Might be a bit tight, actually, I think, Kane.
He might be wearing himself out. Look at the size of the shorts. I'd love to see a big man in or a little man in big shorts. And Roy.
It looks like the Taikini's going low now, too, actually. We might have a tool off here.
The auditory here, as people really are getting involved in this fight. This is a beauty. As Wattapak Chung Parries tries to knock Justin Kane's head off, and now Justin Kane has a go at Ron Plathies' bonce. Oh, it's a bonce off and a tool off here at Darling Harbour. It's absolutely exciting, Roy. This one really is for the fans
great,
of Australia.
Actually, this
look,
is great.
He lights him up. Lights him up. One hand and tries to wake him up with the other.
They're all both trying to hit each other in the tool and then in the head. You know what I mean? It's down below decks and then upstairs. It's fantastic.
No, and you can easily see why the Olympics needs to hang on the boxing.
Oh, yes.
I mean, nothing else gets you like this except for a fight in the Horsley Park car park.
Yes, this is a great fight. It doesn't come any better than this.
Okay, stand up, Thailand and Australia, and be proud of this one, which really is for the fans. And a lot of missed punches as the both boys are getting a little bit tired. Now you'll see the clinches go on as they try and save energy for the next bout.
Not as accurate as they were in the early rounds, are they?
Looks as though Justin Kane in the red is going to go on and record the fifth victory at these games for the Australian boxing team. Tremendous fight. And listen to the roars of the fans as they get involved and willing. And there's a couple of kids, they can't be more than six, having a go at each other. Hammer and Tom's over in the
island. Here we go. 2-1. Yes!
Well done, Justin Kane. A tremendous effort there in the red. And poor old Chodipatwan Wong Parties will be catching the next plane home and probably checking into a monastery in Thailand, Roy.
Somebody out to pay a Karun style, yes.
Can the kid go on? Oh, look at the hair, too. I don't know whether we can get that shot. Maybe Joe, the cameraman, can go back to the other boxer as we see in replay now. Yeah. The last moments of that bout. And I think I hope as we see this whacking away anywhere.
Oh, that was great.
Oh, yes. Look,
are we going to see his traditional backflip?
I'd love to see that. And he's dyed his hair blue. I think he was hoping to fight in blue, but he turned out fighting in red, but it hasn't made any difference. Yeah. There he is, Justin Kane, a deserved winner.
Whoa!
Over the back he goes.
I think he meant to do it green, have it green, as in green and gold, but he got the colour on.
That's right. That wouldn't surprise at all. Oh, it's a tremendous. And I'm just wondering if Joe's got any thoughts here, finally, about the blue hair in particular. I don't know whether we can go down to Joe. We might be able to find him on the sideline.
Joe?
Well, I've got to tell you, I love his hairdo. Nice blue. Hope he doesn't set a trend, because I'm not going to paint mine blue.
What a way to win.
Thanks, buddy.
And now, Dreamsters, can you please welcome Pat Rafter? You know, the feud. I think the feud has been the best thing for tennis. Let me say that right from the start. I can't remember the last really great feud we've had in tennis, and it disappoints me that both you and the poo are trying to hose it off. Yeah. I'd be building it up. I'd be pouring bonfire. I'd never come on this show and smoke the peace pipe, which incidentally is sitting here. Yeah, I don't know if we can get a shot of this.
We've got it here.
The peace pipe here.
Yes,
I'd never agree to do anything like that because I think it's the best thing for tennis.
You should pour petrol on it.
Petrol on it. Yes, yeah, we want you to say something like, you know, if you could, you know, it'll never be solved. It's going to we're going to take it to the grave because it means more to us than life itself.
Can we start to camera?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Mark, I can tell you right now, mate, we'll go to the grave with this. I don't like you one little bit.
Yeah. That's right, keep going.
Yeah. No, he's a good fella. We're starting to sort things out and it's coming along.
Yeah, he's...
That's disappointing.
Yeah, no, well, don't you reckon he's got a big ass? Just for a start. No, I mean, if we're going to get personal.
In the village, everyone sort of has to come together, and we have, and it's been a good bonding session.
Yeah, no, that's...
And who's organised that? Have you had John Alexander in there, or have you had some older tennis heads come along and say, you know, it's not, you know, Nuke, or maybe in Fries popping in to say a couple of words, just to settle things down?
We haven't had him in there.
No, well, that's why it's worked, didn't it?
Yeah. Bloody oath it is.
Yes,
keep these guys out of it.
Well, I think J.A. had a great
feud happening with Alan Stone.
Did he?
I think he did.
Gee,
yeah,
I can't remember that one.
No, it just disappeared.
Yeah,
but
that's right.
It was there for a long time. Oh, yeah, no, J.A.'s had feuds with all sorts. Ray Ruffles.
Ray
he
Ruffles
had a feud with.
Yes.
He didn't talk to Ray Ruffles for the best part of about 8 months. Look, we should just get the symbolism happening. All we need to see, to send the signal out to the world, because this will be reported tomorrow, mm-hmm. and we want to see, say, in the... was the great papers of the world, Washington Post, that sort of thing. Peace pipe smoked.
On dream.
On dream. Mm. So all we need, Pat, is it to be held in that manner. Just near the mouth. That's all.
I don't know if I can do that.
No.
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 All right. So the feud is on.
No, I don't.
Can I?
I just don't smoke.
Oh, no. It's symbols. See, there's no tobacco in there. In fact, look at the logistics of the principle, the scientific principle. Even if that was filled with tobacco and lid, putting your mouth near there with the hand over the mouth like that, you're not going to get any...
It's not going to be.
No.
You think that we could take them the wrong way, though?
Oh.
Hadn't thought of that. Yeah.
What, you mean a headline might be...
Rafter.
Rafter endorses WD and HO Wills or something like that.
Rafter does a warning.
We'd have to have a phone in his hand.
That's right.
Have to have the phone with him as well. Just hold the pipe.
Maybe.
Maybe
we could send Pat with this symbol as a token that either the feud's on or off.
And if we see Mark at some stage...
Maybe playing a set or two with that.
With that symbol, we'll know that the peace pipe is symbolically...
Been passed over.
Yes.
Would it help if you guys, if I just kept this feud going while the Olympics is going?
Yeah, that'd be fabulous. Oh,
absolutely.
That'd be really good.
Oh, no,
really
good.
We couldn't ask for more.
No.
Honestly.
Yes, welcome to Exhibition Halls 1 and 2 in the 100-kilogram class in judo. Kubacki on screen at the moment from Poland. His opponent is Kegs Ruzliakov from Ukraine. Kegs on screen at the moment. He's just put away a couple of chickens before coming out for this 100-kilogram bout. This is the big one, Roy.
It is, actually. These are big men with serious intent to put the other one down on the mat on his back using any means possible.
I tell you, Kubacki doesn't like it. I don't think he's looking very nervous in his approach. Much more confident as Ruslakov goes for a little bit of Osotogari. He takes him down. And now, of course, we get this position where...
This unsightly position
as the coach goes berserk in the corner where they have to break and go back to the centre as the Polish boy takes
tuck
on the thoughts.
Tuck yourself in and start a ladder.
Make yourself respectable. Put the flute back in the top of the trouser and then come in and grapple again. Yeah. It's exciting though, Roy.
It is, actually, but Keggs is a very nimble man despite his size. You'd think a big man like that wouldn't be able to flop over as easily as he does, but he does. He's good.
He's a flopper.
Nimble. And we saw a bit of a grope there from the pole.
That's right. And, of course, the tradition of judo, the gentle way, is full evidence now.
He goes there for it is. Trancy.
He lifted him up off the ground and just threw him forward with a bit of a...
Bit of a frog march.
As we can see now, Keggs coming into his own with stamina.
Yeah.
Plenty of stamina. And Kubacki behind on the scoreboard with Ruzliakov. Keggs Ruzliakov, the Ukraine
Keggs leaves himself open to a wedgie.
He does. Oh, he's got to fight his way out of his own costume
there. Jumping.
Yeah, that's right. Out of his equipment there.
Yeah.
Oh, look, he's flopping about.
He's going on the back door. He's going in backwards.
Yeah.
There we go, wedge.
And Kubacki tries to pick him up and falls over. Keggs, I think, is taking refuge in the mat here. He's wily.
The mat's his friend, isn't it?
The mat. He's made the mat his only friend.
Come on, put yourself, tuck yourself up, fella. Come on, get yourself together.
And obviously a black belt brings the belt back around to tie it around the keg area of the NAB. And he could move to Australia and find plenty of mates to spar with, couldn't
Absolutely.
He, Roy?
Absolutely. And don't people love these big men going at it?
They do.
Fit. These are super fit athletes.
You forget that. These are very, very fit people on the judo mats here. And as we see the Kubacki from Poland now trying to...
He's wedging him again.
I think this is a bit of...
Got him over.
It's rolled him almost.
Rolled the
keg. He sought refuge in the mat, knowing that it's hard to roll a keg, the flat keg. Once now gets up and they come back to the middle, taking his time now. Looks around.
He might need a larger top.
I think he's bulked up since he's been in Sydney.
He keeps wanting to twist around and present him with the door, doesn't he?
He does. He's trying to hit the advantage line.
He's a one-trick wonder. He is. Gets that there it is.
Yeah, no, he's got to develop more skills. He needs more variety. He's got the ice on a gurry and the flop on the ground. Yeah. That's all he's got.
Hang on.
Yeah, no, he knows this.
Now the pole's going to the mat.
Yeah, that's right. Well, the pole's learning from Ruzliakov. He's a tremendously lively customer. Doesn't he hold the Ukraine team together? That's the end of that particular round. And I think from memory, Kubacki's a couple of points in the lead. I wonder what will happen in the fourth. Yeah. I think the 3-1 by the looks, but I might have those scores wrong.
Yes, no, I think you're right, HG. 3-1.
3-1. But on that, Ruzliakov, I think, might in the lead. In fact, there it is. The judges have given it to him. Ruzliakov wins.
And how is an absolute bloody mystery.
Finger-licking Friday. It goes way back, doesn't it, Roy?
It does, HG. Finger-licking Friday. Yeah.
Yes.
It goes back at least as far as 1904, HG, when the games were in St. Louis.
Uh-huh.
St. Louis.
Mm-hmm.
Marvellous games. And I think a bucket of fat was provided to the American team.
Uh-huh.
And they threw live chooks into it.
Is that right? Was that an Olympic sport?
No, I don't think it was. It was just one of those group bonding things that happened spontaneously. And this was carried on in Los Angeles in 32. I think it went to at least Los Angeles in 84, and then, of course, Atlanta in 96. And here it'll be happening today, 2000, over and in the American part of the village, there'll be a big bucket of fat with live chooks being thrown in. It's a marvellous tradition, Finger-licking Friday.
Roy, are the chickens live?
Yes.
When they're thrown in?
They have to be live.
They have to be live.
They have to be
and
live.
Is there a lot of squawking involved? That sort of stuff.
Yeah, but it disappears pretty quickly once they
submerge into the fat.
It sort of goes to a...
Now, this is big news today. Hang on.
You get the board ready.
Okay. HG,
the duck has been broken. The monkey's off their back. New Zealand have a medal. We should have a look at the medal, HG. If we can see the presentation now, I think it's Mark Todd. Is it here?
Mark Todd?
Yeah, here he is. Getting the bronze for the individual 3-day event.
He was on ice by two.
He was, and all of New Zealand erupted. HG, here he is. He's brought home the bronze, and it's absolutely fantastic. A great moment for New Zealand. There he is. He's the one nearest the camera here.
Yes.
There he is there. That's
the bronze
medal. He's got
medalist.
The bronze medal. That's right. Yes. Up he gets onto the podium. He's on the podium, actually. It's not all that high, that podium.
No.
But there he is. And in the wide shot, he's the one on the right. On the bronze.
That's right.
Podium beside the silver and the gold. He's got the bronze. And that's fantastic news, isn't it?
And two things. It's a real monkey off the New Zealand back at the moment.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the other thing is, isn't the Mark Todd story something that all kiddies could emulate?
Yes.
It's a tremendous story.
Giant favourite adversity.
Yes.
Is that the one?
That's the one.
With no skills.
No, that's right. No horse sense. Unable to put two words together and hey presto, he's in the
Sydney Olympics. He's a bronze
medalist. That's right. And he's in the Sydney Olympics. It's tremendous.
So
and
well done, New Zealand, because we share this pride with you.
Oh, yeah.
We do.
Look at this. There it is.
There it is.
Saluting. The trousers are off, but the special shoes are on. I don't know whether you can get this. The special shoes are on in homage to New Zealand this evening. Look at that, and they're very, very happy, the special shoes tonight.
7 News with Tanya Van Heer.
Olympic legend Shane Gould said today she thinks many people are starting to talk about our parrots.
I think many people are starting to talk about our parrots.
IOC heavyweight Dick Pound is ignoring the comment, and the fat-assed wombat continues to offer his support to Australian stars of the Southern Cross, turning up courtside at tonight's Opals Watch match.
But the dome should be rocking tonight. Well, speaking of rocking, look who's turned up at the dome. Fatso the Wombat, and introduced before the referees. I suppose there's a message in there somewhere.
Rutherford Disgrace is wearing those shoes.
Yes, well, let's have a go at putting them on. Thanks very much.
These are real proper shoes.
They are proper running shoes.
When Fatso goes out and about, he'll be able to wear them. I don't know how we're going to go put them on, but that's sort of
what sort are they, Tanya? Are they slashes, volleyoses?
Oh, no. They're the proper shoes.
Oh,
they're
right. Proper shoes. Look at that.
They look great on the old fella, don't they? Because he was born to run.
He was, that's right. Born to run. Look.
Yeah,
oh, the camera can pick it up.
Yeah.
Look there.
Yeah.
See him going by. Let him
go.
That looks much better already.
Yeah,
thanks
does.
Very much. And he looks very, very competitive. Can you please thank Tanya Van Heer?
Thanks, Tanya. Our statistics tonight, HG, these are countries as excited as New Zealand is.
As Newcastle.
Here they are. Armenia. Estonia, Thailand, Kazakhstan, India, Georgia, Portugal, and Kuwait.
Isn't that tremendous?
Tremendous. That's the one bronze club. And there are some great countries there.
They're all great countries. Yeah. And,
and from now, I mean, the dam wall is broken. I think New Zealand's going to run riot with the track and field next week.
I was just going to say, they better send some more people over to compete, I think. What I was going to say was that I agree with you entirely, though. Yep. This whole New Zealand thing has just flowered so beautifully with this toddy boy bringing home the bacon in bronze.
Right. You forget that it was a bronze.
That's right. I was just going to...
It's not just a medal. It was a bronze medal.
Yes, that's right. Bringing home the bacon in the bronze today on that horse.
Breaking the duck. Breaking the duck with bronze. That'll be the headline in the, Auckland Examiner.
Courier or, Times or whatever it's called. Yeah. Breaking the duck with bronze.
Or it might be just a big bronze!
Yeah. Oh. Todd Brown's out with bronze. There's the headline there.
Okay, listen, I can see the typesetter now.
Yeah, hard out of bronze.
Bronze.
Yeah. Gee, that's beautifully done.
Okay.
They'd probably use that too, Roy. Send it over to them. Last night, there was a tragic mistake, which I believe has probably cost certain gymnastic favourites a medal. Mm. And it's a simple problem, Roy, that the vault was 5 centimetres higher than it should have been. Mm. Now, give us an idea of how far 5 centimetres is. Yes, I was going to say about that much myself, actually. I wonder how close we were. Mm. Ooh, you just got a bigger 5 centimetres than me. Let me get that right there. Mm. It's that much higher than it should have been. And it threw some of the highly fancied operators on the vault off, and I believe it coloured their subsequent performances on other apparatus.
Of course it did.
Roy, take us through the pictures. What you've got?
Well, let's have a look, actually. We've got, I think, Svetlana
Kohina
of Russia. Yeah. Here she is. She's confident. She's peppy. And here it is. She doesn't realise it's 5 centimetres higher than it should have been. And so it throws everything out of whack. She hasn't landed on her knees like that in years.
Yeah.
In years. And she's in tears. She thinks...
Can't work out what's going wrong.
Is it me?
Have I got a Perec problem?
Yes.
You know? Should I fly the country?
That threw her right off. Understandably. So then she... we'll see it in slow motion here. Yeah. Had it been 5 centimetres lower, she would have been tickety-boo right on her feet. Not a problem.
Yeah. I think that the SOCOG, the IOC, need to open an inquiry into this. Mm. How can a vault be 5 centimetres higher than its normal position?
No.
And surely
somebody's made a mistake.
Somebody's made a mistake.
Somebody had to set that vault at a particular height. Yeah. There would have been notes, a clipboard, someone would have come around.
With a tape measure?
Yeah, it's got to be that high. Righto, whack her up. All of that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
Looks all right to me. Then they walk away.
Yeah.
Nobody checked it.
Yeah.
Who checked it?
Yeah.
I want a SOCOG IOC dick pound. Or Jacques Rogue. What have they done about it? What have they said about it? Nothing.
No.
Stone cold silence.
And can I say this? That these people who set this equipment up don't have to vault over it. That might irks me. They don't have to run up, hit the floor, up over the top, and then land on their feet and be the funny gear.
No.
You know, they don't have to impress judges. They can lurk about and shimmy about, knowing that they've buggered up. Other people's lives are in danger. Gold medals going down the toilet. I don't mean Atlanta, I mean here in Sydney, because of their mistakes. You know what I mean, Roy? Am I being too harsh?
Absolutely right. Look, the
has got to be restaged. It's got to be restaged.
Yeah, I know.
These medals are null and void from last night.
Look, it's all very well for SOCOG and the Sydney Organising Committee to get to put out this sort of rubbish.
Yes.
All this merchandise.
Club bloody holder, bloody protect the things.
The funny shoes.
The funny shoes.
Sure, they're alive, aren't they? Oh, yes, they're very, very bloody funny.
Oh, yes. Very proactive when it comes to this.
What is that?
Oh, well,
it's a music box.
It's a music box.
Cheerio. Hope the sound has got that. There, stop, Roy. I think I have to turn it up a bit.
No, it spins at the bottom.
Oh, it spins at the bottom. Gee, it's quiet.
It's Waltzing Matilda. Waltzing Matilda. Oh, yeah, that's all right.
All this sort of rubbish.
Oh, that's right,
and then they put the ball five centimetres high. Yeah, that's right. It's an absolute shamozzle.
The Australians, HG, bringing this new move in of opening the bottle.
Yes. Alana Slater.
Yes, we saw the vault work earlier.
This beautiful song. And this, she's telling the story of song of the song in the movement, I Still Call Australia Home.
Oh, there's the opening of the bottle. Oh, with a bit of a skip at the end there.
That's right. Just a little bit of foot movement tacked on to make the space to the corner. And then she comes back now with a tremendous...
Close the bottle.
And away she goes.
Away she goes.
On to the next bit. And this is, of course, she's been to cities that never closed down. And here she is realising that in movement.
Ooh, Dutch wing battered the salve with a half hello, boys, there to finish it off.
That's right. And now in the corner, a wink.
Dutch wink with split.
And up she comes now.
Half a wink again. Quarter wink, we'd call that.
That's right. And here she is just arriving back at Sydney Airport after a long trip around the world. And we'll see her touch down in a minute after a tremendous pass. All that cloud work that she's passing through on descent into Sydney. Here it comes now, the landing. The flaps are down. She's up. The motors are roaring. There she is, back on terra firma.
Ooh, a little bit overbalanced. She pulled it off. I don't think the judges would have noticed that. She's made it look like it was part of the routine.
She made a wink work for her to re-establish, you know, the perpendicular. Often very difficult to do. And, of course, here she is coming through the terminal now with all the other passengers on the plane.
So now she's going to welcome her family who are there to see her. She's off over to the family now. Here I am. Here I am. Home. With a bit of again,
overcorrection.
Yes, overcorrection. Yeah, I think she's pulled it off.
Oh, no, she's wonderful.
Fatso, as you know, has buried his way, tunnelled his way, dug his way into the hearts of most, if not all, Australians. And this has come with some cost, I might say, because the IOC has stepped in. And the IOC has said to us, through the good offices of Seven here, that Fatso is not allowed to appear with athletes anymore. This is Jacques Rogge. Dick Pound.
Yes.
Kevin Gosper.
Yes.
What they won't let you see is images like this. This is now illegal. Let's have a look at the little guy who was out and about today.
Boy, cheers to the eyes of the nation, Roy.
There he is. Grant Hagen. Tom Keneally. There he is with Grant. Grant's taken the little bloke over to see the people. Yeah. And Grant showing the little bloke to his mum and dad. And there's Grant's mum and dad with Fatso. And, and mum in particular just loved the little bloke. Little Fatso. And there's Fatso with Susie. Not allowed to do that anymore. Oh no, it's got to be Sid, Ollie, or Dickhead. Not good enough.
No.
I mean, even Australia Post have taken to Fatso.
Yeah.
Look here, there's the little guy.
Bam. And when people want to get in touch with each other, now they can lick his date.
Yes.
That's how bloody popular he is. Sure, in the past he's just eaten, rooting and left.
Yes.
But now, like that before you put it on a stamp.
Yeah. Even though you don't have to lick anymore. People have started licking again.
Yeah, that's right. Because they want a taste of Fatso.
They want a taste of Fatso. Yeah.
What are we going to do about it, Roy?
Well, We're going to try it on.
Are we?
We're going to try it on. Mm. We're going to let the athletes and the people decide. And the IOC can get stuffed.
7 News with Shane Gould.
In other news, Olympic swimming legend Dawn Fraser today claimed Australia was the best country in the world.
Australia is the best country in the world.
IOC heavyweight Canadian Dick Pound has refused to comment on the Fraser claim. And that's all for the news. Peace be with you.
Excellent.
We must seize the moment before it steals away. Let's unite with all our might to seize that moment today. Protect the earth with all your worth. Exercise damage control. Play any sport as if you want to be after Olympic gold. We must seize the moment before it steals away. A shining light, a bird in flight. We must seize the moment today. There'll be no more crime against mankind, no persecution or war. Let's rejoice in common voice, and your heart it will soar. Let's get together, let's forget the past. Raise your hands, touch the stars, seize the moment. Winds only once, no one knows when it will end. We are the people of the world, and we'll seize the moment today.
And now the gold medal frenzy continues here on The Dream as we welcome two of the historic women's gold medal water polo team in Liz Weeks and Debbie Watson. Yeah. The Russians were particularly heavy on the contact side of it, and that in fact some of the suits you were wearing are absolutely torn to ribbons in this. Now, me and Roy got out a suit and we tried to pull it apart.
We tried to pull it apart.
We tried to pull it apart and we couldn't.
So the Russians. Strong enough.
Well, I guess
you want to have a go?
We just can't get it. So you can hear it going.
It's incredible. I mean, it must be.
It's easy. Do you want to see?
Yeah.
Let's go. Hang on. Oh, hang on. Maybe it's not. We need these ones.
Oh, and the referees blow the whistle a lot. Is there a controversy about when they blow? You know, as in. Oh, let's.
Well, sometimes no, not really. Sometimes we think they don't blow often enough, and yeah. Sometimes, you know, sometimes you get too much, sometimes not enough. So.
This is the really big one. This is the big one that couldn't be held out, could not be denied. This is Rob Waddell winning New Zealand's first gold medal in the single sculls. Take it away, Rob. Here's a New Zealander going for gold, putting his back into it. He will not be denied. The courage of Fatso took him over the line. New Zealand, stand up and cheer. Stand up and cheer. There's an exhausted Kiwi in the boat getting New Zealand's first gold. And the second place getter can't believe that a New Zealander's got gold. He has to inspect it. Taps him on the back. And tomorrow in New Zealand, this is the medal tally. Yes. And here's the headline. Waddell's golden shower. Oh,
that's
yes.
Fantastic. And don't New Zealanders perform at their best when they're sitting down going backwards?
While we're out at the rowing today, out at Penrith,
yes,
we were lucky enough to have a sight of what I consider one of the finest human beings the ever to be associated with.
ISE.
I'm referring to Princess Anne, and have a look at how the boys' lunchbox had put it as the Princess Royal comes along and hands out the medal.
They're paying attention, aren't they? They are indeed, in
this magnificent event run by Steve Redgrave and his team to become the first athlete to win 5 gold medals in 5 successive Olympics. Never been done before. And just have a look at how excited those Italian boys are. They're really excited. And don't tell me, firstly, that victory doesn't get you aroused, and don't tell me that they aren't all deliriously happy to be associated nearby the Princess Royal, Princess Anne. She is still a real bug magnet, isn't she? A real bug magnet. And it's tremendous. It just goes on and on and on. Yeah. I think that we'll see a little bit more. Yes. There they all are lined
proudly
up there.
Standing to
proudly.
Attention.
Even the Australians are infected by it. I think they might have come third in that particular event, but be that as it may, they got it. They got up close to the Royal
and they
found it a very
good result.
You can't.
You can't. I'm going to sit down whenever she comes around.
Indeed. And it's a pity there weren't chairs available for those blokes. It would have been much less embarrassing a picture.
How proud are they?
Really proud.
The snatch goes on with Rudik Petrosyan from Armenia.
Yeah, he's touchy, this bloke, isn't he? He's very sensitive.
He can go off like a mobile phone.
Yeah.
There's the buzzer. He's got 150 kilograms on the bar. He's got to attack this now.
Yep.
He's got to attack this now in the Collingwood colours up top. And
look, he can do it, though.
I think he can do it. If anybody in this room can do it, he can do it. He's one of the few in this room.
Hang on, that was a mobile phone just went off there, HG. I don't know if that's going to upset the bloke at all.
Jeepers creepers, I hope not.
No, he'll be right. He's concerned. Yeah.
He thinks bloody hell, he better get a wriggle on.
Yeah.
Look, this proves this.
Hang on, there's another noise.
Here we go. Oh, no. Ah. Sensation here at the weightlifting in the 6-0
kilogram.
He's touching the forehead. He's trying to beam him up, Scotty. He's been fouled out, Roy. Fouled out. He didn't take the lift in his time. And listen to this crowd. This could get ugly, Roy. We might be in the centre of a controversy.
I've never seen anything like it, HG. I mean, he had plenty of time. It's as if he got out there and a brain fuse. He forgot what he...
Look, this proves exactly what you say, Roy. The 6 steps of weightlifting.
He forgot to lift.
Never forget them. As we watch the judges, the officials on screen now, trying to work out what's going on. Mm-hmm. The mobile phones seem to mozz him.
Yeah.
The officials have been asking people not to have mobile phones here as we see Rudik trying to
think. What did I have to do? Lift it. What's the line? I forgot
to lift it. I forgot to lift the bugger.
Well, anyway.
Yes, and now on the Dream, it's time to welcome a gold medalist in the form of weightlifter Tara Knott. Can you believe it?
Yes.
Tara, big welcome. Tara, you should quickly explain that you'll be getting your medal tomorrow morning due to problems with the people who were ahead of you being found positive for drug intake. And so you find yourself in a position with a gold, being the gold medalist, but you don't have a gold medal to show us at the moment.
Correct. I was supposed to get the medal today at 4 o'clock.
Yes.
However, I had a teammate competing at 4:30, and the IOC, Dick Pound, wouldn't change the time of the medal ceremony. So I skipped the medal ceremony and went to watch my teammate, Cheryl Hayworth, win the bronze.
Right. Isn't that typical of Dick Powell?
It is. He's.
No flexibility whatsoever.
And once again, athletes, the last people considered at Olympic Games.
Because it didn't suit Dick.
To come at another time.
Or
it didn't suit Dick to consider that United States, on Finger Lickin' Friday, may have people participating in competition.
That's right.
Typical of Dick.
Typical of Dick.
Mm. Look, picking up from where we left our interview with Tara, who's obviously going down to get a gold medal, I think, sometime tomorrow now.
Depends on when Dick Pound can fit her in.
Yes, it will. And, you know, even if he said 10:30 tomorrow, would you trust him? No, he'd find...
Oh, he'd leave you hanging around.
In a waiting room somewhere.
Until he'd finished his coffee.
That's right. Croissant. Yeah, that's right.
Thank you very
much. Now, there was a bizarre ceremony yesterday because
Ivan Ivanov had lost his gold medal in weightlifting as well, and I'm not sure that he's not in the 48 kilogram class as well, but he'd lost his gold medal due to, you know, obviously
difficult being, circumstances.
Well, I was just going to use a term like chock-a-block full of the angry pills.
He was,
I think they pumped. Although, you know what, if I could get rid of a word, I'd get,
get rid of pumped.
Yeah, thanks very much. I think we can do without
it. Spiked.
Spiked.
Was he spiked?
I suppose so. Yes, that's right. No, he's
laced.
Laced. Chuck a block full of the angry pills. And so we had this rather bizarre ceremony, hastily cobbled together by Mayor Richardson, over at the village. So as the Chinese lad who finished third could then receive a silver medal, and the Chinese lad who finished fourth could receive the bronze medal.
That's right.
Now, you were lucky enough to take the dream cameras out there. And look, it was a triumph of organisation on behalf of Richo.
Yeah.
And is that where we start with this package?
Well, I think we start somewhere around there, actually. Let's have a look.
There's obviously confusion.
Where we are. Is Richo handling it all? The chair's been brought in, obviously. That's for dignitaries to sit at. Here's Richo.
Look, he's moving about.
A medal?
Bronze and the silver. So
he's cool. So was it a competition already?
We're going to...
He's a
comedy. These are comedy for the neatest team in the village.
That'll do.
Can you translate for the...
First time that medals that happen to be rearranged as a result of cheating and doping tests will be presented in public. The International Olympic Committee is determined to do everything it can to make sure that Olympic competitions are fair and that results are not artificially affected by reason of cheating on the part of other athletes. Would you ask Wu Wengxiong to come forward?
Absolute shambles, isn't it, Roy?
They'll remember that for the rest of their lives, won't they?
They will. And you see how lucky the Olympic movement is to have somebody like of the calibre, the organisational skills, the presence of mind, as Mayor Richo Richardson, over there to make Dick Pound look bloody good.
Yeah, he did.
He held him up.
He did.
All the way through
that. Dick was kind of ordinary.
He was very, very
well, ordinary. In all fairness, Richo only had half an hour's warning, I think.
Well, that's what I mean.
Yeah, the blue went up. You know, Dick was on the phone. He'd forgotten to tell him.
Yeah,
it's on now. You know, get over there. Yeah. Oh, Christ almighty.
What do we do?
We organised
no
a band.
No, that's
well,
right.
The band was there setting up, but they were obviously far too bloody late.
Yeah, that's no. Right. Oh, no.
That was an absolute travesty.
It was. And
it looked amateur. It looked amateur.
Thanks. It looked.
That's what worries me.
Yeah. Like the 5 centimetres on the vault.
That's
amateur.
Right. That's
amateur.
Right.
Amateur.
It didn't look anything like the opening ceremony.
I must confess, I hadn't anticipated it would. The good news is Trevor and Duncan Pound are here with us this evening.
Dick's boys.
Oh, Dick's boys, all the way from Canada. They're clapping to blend in with the rest of the audience. And we had a bit of a chat in the break, and they agree their dad looked absolutely
ordinary
in that little bit of medal ceremony, and they're disappointed.
They didn't know where to look.
No, that's right. And they're disappointed with SOCOG and the IOC that a better ceremony couldn't have been organised.
Right. That's right. We're not. I mean, I don't think it was Dick's fault.
He is a busy bloke.
He's busy. You've got to look at Jacques Rogge.
That's
are there any of Jacques? Are we Rogge free in here tonight? Good. Yeah, Jacques, wrong. Done nothing.
Yeah.
Just in the way.
Oh, no, look, I think you can cheat at home to Kevin Gosper. I mean, forget the Canadians. It's Lord Gosper.
Lord
Gosper. Bang it up totally. We're now back at the gymnastics, Roy, and I understand that you've been speaking to a lot of the gymnasts, a lot of the foreign gymnasts, who are disappointed by the lack of bounce in the floor.
Yeah,
they're not getting any support off the floor.
No, it's a bit stiff, especially for some of the more provocative moves, HG, causing all sorts of difficulty for the downstairs department of many of our particular male.
I understand. I understand the battered salve.
Well, the battered salve's causing all sorts of difficulty.
You're distressed.
Doctors are scratching their heads. You know, they've never seen so much sort of mince work downstairs.
In their lives.
In their lives.
And how are they coping with the mince work, Roy? Just sticking it in a...
cotton and needle.
Cotton and needle, or I understand a bucket of ice is very good, and you alternate the
hot
ice...
Hot sand.
Hot sand, yeah, that's right. Alternate the ice or the hot sand. With that as a way of an introduction, let us go and have a look at a few foreigners battering the sand.
With the drink cameras once again at the Superdome for the men's gymnastics floor routine. Roy, it's a wonderful night of pure strength here tonight.
Oh, yes, it is. There's a lot of pressure on the Russians here, HG. They've been having a lot of landing problems. Pardon me, landing problems all week, as we well know. So the first up, I think, is
Alexei Bondarenko from Russia, from the Russia. Lucky socks on. And this bloke can party, Roy. He really knows how to have a good time. And he's here in Australia having a good time. And Roy, take us through this what I think will be a wonderful display. The hands in the air and off he shoots.
Off he shoots, HG. Just a little bit of electric work there with a double spin. Again, on landing difficulty there. I don't know what's going on with the Russian landings at the moment. This will be a confidence builder for him, though. The corkscrew, double corkscrew, and then a...
Bat of the serve.
Bat of the serve. A bit of hello boys there. And crazy date. It's the first crazy date we've seen with total elevation. 360-degree crazy date, actually. Look at that.
And it's going every which way, the crazy date. Yeah, almost turning into a party date.
Yes, the crazy date. Oh, close the door.
And he's spinning off the flute here. He's got the flute out.
And the
a flat bag with the arms extended there. A lovely flat bag. Here he goes. Hello, boys.
Hello, boys. It's me.
A simple sidestep to reposition himself for the next pass. Beautifully thought through that little bit.
It certainly was.
Here he goes. Here he goes. A big jump. Back he comes that way. Ooh, he spins the hat of the salve.
Batted salve. Tremendous strength in that batted salve. He really enjoys that work.
He's holding it beautifully. There must be swelling already. He comes now towards the camera position here.
Up he goes. Oh, no. We're going to lose points for that as well, HG.
The landings.
Bucket up the landings tonight completely. I mean, I hate to use words like that, but... It was a real bucket of slop, wasn't it?
Yes. Well, the whole thing, really. But the wigwams, the filge, and the battered salve, I thought was well worth the price of
admission. Oh, absolutely. This is Dmitry Drivin. And again, he might have landing troubles too, HG.
One of the Russians.
Earlier in the week. But he has a wonderful closed door. And
his tool bag you'd travel to see, wouldn't
his
you?
His flat bag. His flat bag, yeah. Here we go. Is it just a settler, a couple of spins and a twist and a double twist?
Back into the corner.
Yep, into the wrong position.
Here he goes. He's got to get this together now. Russia, of course, looking for a big spin out from Dravin. He's there. He's onto the salve. Straight away.
Straight away. Into a 360-degree closed door, and it's me. Closed door with the it's me position. He'll go into a flat bag. Didn't expect that.
Here with a hand in here. Beautiful flat bag.
Beautiful flat bag.
Then he's just...
A, hello, boys. And the door. He does do the... No, he didn't do any crazy date or party date for us tonight, actually. Great shame.
He's got a beautiful party date, this boy. And up he goes over the top there. Bangs the flute into the floor for another battered salve and offers the toolbox to the judge. Because he's got the arm home. Then close the door in the vertical. Out with the hands, ready for the final pass. And here he comes. He hopes to nail this there. He's across that way. He goes up around. He goes and bangs the... All night, the Russians and landings. What is it?
Alexei Nemov is onto the
electric.
He spits on his hands.
He said to me actually this afternoon that this was his favourite apparatus.
Is that right? Apparatus?
The mat.
Yeah, he must roll it up and take it over.
Right at the end of the competition. Nemov set to rock this grand old girl here at Homebush.
Here we go, series of spinning dates.
Spinning dates to get him going.
Twinkle
in the sparkling position, and then he comes back to the corner to reset himself. Gathers his thoughts.
Up he goes again.
Spinning Dad, Spinning Dad with Sparkle, with Twinkle, Ford,
Batted Sav.
Batted Sav and the bounce, and that was Mother's.
Hello Boys, Crazy Date.
Inverted Crazy Date.
And more
and Hello Boys with Crazy Date. And the roll! Flatbag. That was brilliant. Listen,
Hello Boys.
Straight to the commentary position.
It's me.
And then he's up.
A white book.
Into the corner. A bit of a goose.
Haven't seen one of those.
Crazy Date. Spinning Date. Back into a batter serve.
And another Hello Boys.
Ooh, a fully flung flatbag Hello Boys.
And I'm home into the corner with a lammy leap.
Yes.
Scoring well so far.
So many new moves here. I've never seen this.
Spinning date.
Oh, marvellous. Oh, that's full marks. Slight bounce at the end, but that's full marks. That's the most extraordinary routine I've ever seen. That series of Crazy Date was brilliant. I'd give him 9.8, 9.9. What's he got?
9.8.
9.8.
And the Crazy
that's
Date
giving him the gold. Each
and year. I think it has. It's given Alexei Nemov the goal here in the individual men's gymnastics artistic. He's going up. That's tremendous.
Sydney, we love you.
You can't get enough of that gymnastics, can you?
It's good. I think the standard is higher now than ever before. Well, it's interesting. We had Nadia Comaneci on the program, I think it was last Saturday night, was it?
Yes.
And looking at her work back from 1976, looked quite ordinary compared to today's, didn't it?
It does. I don't know how she got a 10, you know.
I don't know. You should have got about 2 if she trotted out that sort of rubbish.
Do you know
these
what?
Days.
I don't mean to blow our own trumpet, but I think the standard's improved since you and I began calling it.
Can I just say, I do have a fatso feedback, an email, HG, from
Bolivia,
from our good friend Toto Arvalo.
Yes.
Toto Arvalo.
Yes.
From Deporte Total in Bolivia.
Yes.
Who wished us...
Just simply to say...
To say, hi, hello, Bolivia.
How about that?
Toto Arvalo.
He's a real mover and shaker.
He's a mover and shaker.
In Bolivia. He's sort of their version of...
Dick Pound. Tell you what, speaking of Dick Pound, there's a lot of pressure on Dick now and Jacques, and not so much Juan Antonio because he gets out of the picture next year, but there's a lot of pressure on Sydney to accept the games back here in 4 years' time to relieve... Yeah! I think this would be an enormous relief to the administrators, organisers and people of Athens.
Yes, somebody compared with coming to Sydney to have the games and moving it somewhere else was like if you were dating Cindy Crawford, why look elsewhere?
Yes. This was an American. This was for the Washington Post, I think.
Is he actually dating Cindy Crawford?
I believe he is.
He knows what he's talking
exactly
about.
He knows exactly what he's talking about.
Righto. And, of course, we end the show every night, The Dream, with the Hearts of Gold.
Hearts of Gold.
What a story this is. What a story this is turning into. Ordinary people expressing in song their...
Joys, hopes, desires.
...of the Olympics and Australia, and their spirit has been touched by the flame, and this is their outpouring. And tonight it's an absolute ball terror, Roy.
Yes, it is.
I think it's called Go You Good Thing.
Ah, this is sensational.
And it
isn't
features the line, Go You Good Thing, put a gap in them.
That's right.
We say farewell from The Dream and leave you once again with Hearts of Gold. Go You Good Thing.
Put a gap in them.
You're born for this.
Born for this.
The time is now. You've trained for this.
Trained for this.
The time is now. You live for this.
Lives for this.
The time is now. You're born for this.
So take your best.
I'm sure you'll both be interested to know that a record was set here in Brisbane this morning on local radio.
Oh, yes.
The radio announcer said Dick Pound four times in the space of 20 seconds in the morning news.
Is that right? Is that right?
This is once every 5 seconds. Indeed, a world record.
I find that hard to believe. You can construct a sentence with Dick Pound in it.
I suppose I could.
What's the bet? 20 seconds?
20 seconds.
Once every 5 seconds.
I bumped into Dick Pound this morning. I said, Dick, how are you, buddy?
Yeah. Are you still pounding?
Are you still pounding?
Did you see the dream last night? Your boys, Dick Pound, were on it, you know?
Hey, Dick Pound, are you Dick Pound? The real Dick Pound? Is that you, Dick Pound?
Yeah, there.
Do you want to Dick Pound? Dick Pound. Quick one from Dick Pound.
Yes?
He says, message, no, it's not the Dick Pound.
No, it's Dick
everyone's favourite IOC member. I'm just a regular bloke from Ballarat who wants to thank Fatso for making me famous in our quaint town. Everywhere I go, townsfolk are asking me for my autograph. Isn't that great?
Isn't that fantastic? Isn't that hard to imagine there's two people on the planet called Dick Pound?
Yeah.
I don't know if anybody can understand this show from another country, but if tourists were watching...
Well, they do in Bolivia, don't they?
That's right. Yeah, hello, Bolivia.
Introducing the limited edition Samsung Olympic Games phone. What better way to share the moment?